good afternoon as CBS presents live flag-to-flag coverage of one of the most competitive motorsports events there is. The Talladega 500, 40 drivers racing for nearly a $500,000 today on the 2.6-mile, five-story high bank track, the Alabama International Motor Speedway. The weather today, we're being haunted by dark clouds, but it looks like we're going to be off to a start on time and see some record speeds. Good afternoon. I'm Ken Squire here at Talladega, Alabama, where we're just about set for the commencement of the 16th Talladega 500. The field is amassed down below us on pit road, and I'm delighted to have working with us as co-host a gentleman who's been here and shared all 15 past races with us. That's Ned Jerry.
Ken, this track has created some the finest finishes that we have seen in all of auto racing. It has a unique way of producing winners from the relative unknowns in the sport. 14 different drivers have taken the checkered flag in the first 15 races. Only Darrell Waltrip has been able to repeat. The drafting effect they have here helps to keep the cars running close together. But I think another contribution to the close finishes we see is where the start-finish line is located, almost down to turn one, as opposed to in the center of the tri-oval like we see it at most tracks. It causes the drivers to have to set up a little bit differently on that last lap, produce some real fine finishes. It wouldn't surprise me to see four, five, or six cars running for the finish, for the win here today.
Well, let's right now show you just how dramatic the races can be here at Talladega. This was one day ago, the International Race of Champions held here on this track. 12 of the world's very best drivers. This was the very first lap. Benny Parsons in the black car, and on the outside of the white car, Derek Bell of Great Britain and Neil Bonnett in the yellow car. It is Bell crashing out of turn four into the wall, and watch Bonnett in the yellow car rotating, sailing into the air. Amazingly, Benny Parsons, who took a real hard hit in that black Chevrolet Camaro, was able to come out and come from 11th position to lead and dominate the race until the final lap. And here we are, going to turn three, final moments. That's Cale Yarborough in the dark blue car on the inside, moving down past Benny Parsons. And in the light blue car comes Darrell Waltrip. Parsons was driving hurt. He crashed at 190 miles per hour in practice on Friday. They didn't even expect he would start this IROC race, and he had dominated the event. Here they come for the finish, and this shows you just how tight, how close it can be at Talladega. Down to the line, Yarborough deployed first. Waltrip almost and into the apron for a moment, and at the line, Waltrip won by a foot. Let's not talk about yesterday, Benny Parsons, who is going to share the booth with us today. Let's talk about this Talladega 500.
I think that we have to rate the 28 car, Cale Yarborough, as the favorite, because for the past 5 or 6 years, the 28 car, whoever was driving it, has been the dominant force at Daytona and Talladega. But in May, Ken, I drove here against these cars, and the number 9 car, Bill Elliott, seemed to me like one of the best cars that I ran with all day. I would expect the winner to come from the front row.
Now, let me point out that Benny Parsons' car had qualified 9th for the event on Friday. The car was eliminated in a terrible crash here, and we're just delighted to have you in the booth and okay and running so well yesterday.
I'm glad I can be here, Ken. Believe me, getting up these steps was the greatest thing I've ever done.
Right. Let's go to Mike Joy with a man on the pole for the Talladega 500.
I'm with a pole-winning team, Ken Carner, Harry Rainier, engine builder Waddell Wilson, and the man, Cale Yarborough. You've won the spring race here and sat on the pole countless times, but you've never won here in the July-August race. Why?
Well, if I knew why, I would have won. I don't know. We run good here, and I hope today we're going to put an end to that. This Hardy Chevrolet is running good, and Waddell and the entire team has been working hard, and, you know, it's left up to me now. I got the car to do it with, and I'll just do my best to put it in the winner's circle.
For the last two times you've tried your patented slingshot move in the last lap from second spot, it's backfired. Have you rethought that after yesterday and after July at Daytona?
Well, July, the caution flag came out and caught me in the wrong position. Yesterday, the flag of stand was in the wrong position, and so I've been beat twice by things being out of position, so we want another shot at it, though.
As we mentioned, that extra 1,200 feet of racing down to the start-finish line makes a difference here at Talladega. It's a Chevy versus Ford front row. Cale Yarborough on the pole, and alongside the Dawsonville, Georgia driver, Bill Elliott. On the pole and in victory lane on CBS at Michigan. On the pole at Pocono. Back on the front row once again. In a virtual deadlock with Cale, 202.4 miles per hour. You folks have really found some horsepower here.
Well, the car's been working well, and Ernie does a heck of a good job on the engines, and seems like everything's falling together the last several races.
A lot of folks were really thrilled for you when you won that race at Michigan here on CBS, and it had to be a great lift for your team, and it looks like it really got you off to a great start for the second half of the year.
No doubt about it, and I hope I can make it too here on CBS.
Well, this has always been a race of dark horses, and the front row have never won this race. Back up to you, Ken.
Bill Elliott has one of our CBS onboard cameras with him in our live flag-to-flag coverage of what has always been a monumental struggle. Stand by for the race and the starting lineup for the Talladega 500. The starting lineup for the 1984 Talladega 500. The front row, Cale Yarborough and Bill Elliott, both qualifying at over 202 miles an hour and breaking the old Talladega record. A Chevrolet and a Ford. Row two is Dale Earnhardt, the 1983 winner, and Texas Terry Labonte. He's currently third in the Grand National standings. Row three is Tommy Ellis, the real dark horse in this race from Virginia, car four. And beside him comes Buddy Baker, who won in 1975. Going to row four, the two-time winner of the event, it's Darrell Waltrip in car 11, and beside him, Neil Bonnet, who pulled it off in 1980. Row five is Ron Bouchard, who had that tremendous win here in 81, and Rusty Wallace. Going to row six, Richard Petty, who won it back in 1974, and Dave Marcus, the 76 winner. In row seven, it's Jody Ridley and Harry Gant, fresh from his win at Pocono. In row eight, Lake Speed from Mississippi, and Bobby Allison, who won this race. In row nine, Phil Parsons, and beside him, Richard Brooks, also a previous winner in 73. Row 10 is the all-time great. A.J. Foyt is back and looking strong in the Dick Hutcherson car and Sterling Marlin. Row 11 is Phil Buckdahl, new name from Iowa, and Greg Sachs from New York. Going to row 12, Tim Richmond is there in car 27, and Ricky Rudd at the Ford number 15. Row 13 is the Chrysler of Buddy Arrington and Kyle Petty's Ford. Row 14, Joe Rutland from California, and Jeff Bodine, who's won twice in the short tracks this year. Row 15 is Trevor Boyce from Canada, and former Rookie of the Year, Ronnie Thomas. Row 16, Grant Adcox, ready to settle down, and Bobby Hillen from Texas. Harvard in row 17 is Mike Alexander from Tennessee and Randy Baker. In row 18, it's Ken Reagan, the Georgia driver, and Morgan Shepherd in car 52. Row 19 is Colorado's Clark Dwyer and Eddie Dershowitz from Texas. In row 20, Elliott Forbes Robinson and Steve Moore round out the field for this Talladega 500.
This CBS Sports Special, the Talladega 500 from the Alabama International Motor Speedway, is sponsored by Pontiac. Cars that tell the world you're not just along for the ride. Pontiac, we build excitement. Bud Light, the light beer with a taste that's satisfying but never filling. And by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts.
Bud Light? If you just ask for a light beer, you never know what you'll get.
Give me a light. Bud Light.
So if you want the less filling light beer
with
the first name and taste, don't just ask for a light beer.
Give me a light.
Ask them to bring out their best.
Bud Light.
Bud Light. Because everything else is just a light.
Want to build a super day? Then start with the one great taste that makes a super bowl of cereal. Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Just think of crispy golden flakes.
Delicious, crunchy flakes of corn.
So pure and simple, just can't wait.
Low in sugar, loaded with vitamins and iron.
So good for you, don't hesitate.
of our most nutritious cornflakes ever.
What a Super Bowl! And it's not the Super Bowl. Kellogg's cornflakes. Super taste, super good. Kellogg's cornflakes.
We await the start of the 16th running of the Talladega 500, a race of dark horses on many previous occasions. The leading dark horse in this race is standing by with Mike Joy.
Well, no question, Ken Squire. Tommy Ellis, former national sportsman champion. He's been at the top of the sport. He's been suspended out of the sport. Now he's got himself a good Grand National ride, and he's fifth on this starting grid. That surprised a lot of people, but you weren't one of them.
No, we wasn't surprised. We knew we could run good before we came down here, and we figured we'd run over 200, and we did. We was very pleased to be fifth. Of course, you know, we always want to do a little bit better. We thought we could have run any top three when we qualified, and I probably missed the line a little bit here or there, and it's probably lack of experience, but we feel like we can run good in the race, and the crew just did a great job, and the engine people, Horns and Eames from Richmond, have been giving us real good engines, and we've really been running good. We just need to finish the race and have a real good run here today.
It's a good chance for Tommy Ellis to show well today. Let's go further back on the grid to Chris Economaki.
Thanks, Mike. Well, in keeping with the recognition that automobile racing is receiving this year, this automobile, the number 43 Plymouth, that Richard Petty drove to an unprecedented 200th victory in the July 4th race at Daytona Beach, has been asked for by the Smithsonian Institution. It will hang alongside the plane that Charles Lindbergh crossed the Atlantic in. Richard, what do you feel about your car going in the Smithsonian?
Well, I tell you, it's just going to be a piece of history. And from that standpoint, it's going to be a super deal for us in race hosting.
Good luck today.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Richard Petty, a piece of history, starting up this number 43 for its last race before it goes in the repository of American history in Washington, D.C., the Smithsonian Institute. Back to you, Kemp.
And the man driving a piece of history, winner of 200 Grand National races in his illustrious career, going for his second win in this, the Talladega 500. 2.6-mile track, high bank, 33 degrees on both ends, 18 degrees, just a tad higher than Daytona. Greg Sachs having a problem here. The New York driver out of the modified ranks, Greg Sachs, having problems. Foot is up on car number 51.
Ken, this is a disappointing situation for a driver when he tries to fire the car and it won't go. Of course, hoping they will be able to get him fired up and get him on out in the race.
Here are the cars that did not qualify for this running of the Talladega 500. Dal McCoward's car, Rick Wilson, Blackie Wainwright from up in Minnesota, Tommy Gale, the Sonny King car, J.D. McDuffie had trouble here. And Rick Newsom blew an engine before qualifying. Of course, Benny Parsons had a terrible accident in turn number four, eliminating their Super Speedway car, the Johnny Hayes team. Field rolling out. 188 laps. There's Sachs' car being pushed as they try to fire it. Having their problems. Two laps, and they will turn them loose today here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway, where we have seen so many upsets, so many surprises in past years. Field rolling. One car having trouble. We'll be back with a start of the Talladega 500 live on CBS in a moment.
I'm Mr. Goodwrench. You know what starts when your engine starts? Engine wear.
50 strokes, 100 strokes, 200 piston strokes of wear per second. Only a fine lubricant can protect it. Introducing new GM Goodwrench Motor Oil. The motor oil from General Motors that meets or exceeds all GM specifications.
Great protection from me, Mr. Goodwrench.
To keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM.
Like a lot of people, I'm taking better care of my body. Better care of my skin, too.
With Skin Bracer Aftershave.
Shaving is rough, so I use Skin Bracer.
It cools and smooths skin. Tightens pores. That's the tingle.
Smells great, too. But Skin Bracer's not cologne. It's skin care that feels good. That's why more men are saying, thanks. I needed that.
Skin Bracer, now in Spice, too. Takes care of men who take care of their skin. Skin Bracer Aftershave.
By men.
Well, goodbye, good old Head and Shoulders. Gotta use new, improved Head and Shoulders. Come on, what makes this better than this?
Controls dandruff better than ever.
What's to improve? All right, it's richer. And it smells nice. Hey, really nice. Improved? It's great!
Hey, your hair looks gorgeous.
Yeah, well, always knew I'd like it better anyway.
New improved Head & Shoulders in regular and conditioning formulas.
Scope presents The Way It Was.
Mama, mouthwash tastes like medicine.
Oh, baby, if it didn't, it wouldn't work.
Alex believed it. Today, he still does.
Hey, Big Al. Hmm? If you're going dancing, try Scope. It's minty. Tastes good.
Then it doesn't fight bad breath.
Hey, Scope works. Don't let the good taste fool you.
Ah, cool. Tingly.
Fresh breath at last.
Mama won't believe it.
Mama!
Scope works. Don't let the good taste fool you.
You are aboard Richard Petty's car, number 43, starting from the 11th position in today's race. How about it on the start, Richard Petty? What do you intend to make for a maneuver to catch up with those guys in front?
Well, I don't see how everybody goes. Once we get straight away, then we'll try to do a little bit of racing.
Richard, are you going to have to do a lot of drafting today?
You're breaking up pretty bad. You're not coming through too good, am I?
The question is, are you going to have to do a lot of drafting today out here, Richard?
We'll have to do a whole lot of drafting. My car's really not running that good, so if I'm able to keep up, it's going to be strictly in a draft.
Good luck to you today, and a blessing for Richard Petty that he comes through with a safe and successful race. And now you're inside Bill Elliott's car, number 9, on the outside of the front row. This incredible team out of Georgia, family operation. Remember his dad and his brothers with him in Victory Lane when we were last with you on CBS. Here he is outside in the front row. Just to his left is Cale Yarborough. Now, there's no audio from him today. We had a camera prepared for Benny Parsons, and when he tagged the wall at 190 miles per hour, the camera came back, but the audio didn't, Ned. Tim, Richard Petty talking about the drafting a moment ago, said his car wasn't running quite up to par. You'd have to do a lot of drafting. We saw some cars in the late practice yesterday that were 6-7 miles an hour off the pace of Cale Yarborough qualifying, and they were able to run 202 miles an hour. Jeff Bodine is carrying our third camera. He's starting back in 28th position. And there you are. We don't have a moment to talk to them as they're coming down to the start in the trial. Remember, start-finish line some 400 feet beyond it. There you see the safety car coming in. The crowd cheering them down for a start. Responsive congregation here in Alabama to see another one of these great spectacles in the most competitive automobile racing in the world. Coming to the line, you're with Bill Elliott coming down. There you see Cale Yarborough on the inside, edging the familiar Harry Rainier car out in front of there, over the line and underway. 188 laps in the 16th annual near $500 million Talladega 500. Yarborough for the lead in the early going.
It shows how strong the engine is in that car. And on the acceleration, he just moved right away from Bill Elliott. Dale Earnhardt in a Chevrolet followed right on the back bumper off Cale Yarborough.
Greg Sachs was ready to fire, and he came into the event. Back straight away, first time. There's that number 3. That is Earnhardt, last year's winner, trying to be the first man to win 2 in a row. And Tommy Ellis. Tommy Ellis out of Virginia, moving up in there, going for second place.
Had to be a great moment for him as he drafted by Cale Yarborough.
Fourth place now. Remember, Tommy Ellis, relative newcomer, seen most of his Grand National experience all this year. But don't forget, he had a fourth place finish in the National 500 at Charlotte a few years back. Ellis now in second place. Earnhardt trying to be the first man to win this race back-to-back 2 years in a row in turn number 2. Ellis in the second spot, trying to be one of those dark horses to pull it out. Will it be a different winner this year?
About 15 cars have pulled away from the balance of the pack back there, Ken. But these cars are so evenly matched. We see Kenny coming up on the inside, right behind Ron Bouchard.
Into 6th, trying for 5th. Tremendous shuffle of automobiles down into turn number 3. Earnhardt stays on the point. And Tommy Ellis, the man they used to call Terrible Tommy, just an incredible racer, holding on, the former national champion. He could be the scourge of Grand National Racing, 36 years old, the new team. We'll tell you more about it as the day progresses. Here he comes. 3 wide down to the tri-oval. Across the line. A staccato roar of automobiles as they snap by our high-speed camera here.
Earnhardt was very quick to move to the lead. There's 5 bonus points, and here goes
Bill Elliott.
Bill Elliott on the inside of Tommy Ellis. But those 5 bonus points with Earnhardt leading them going into this race, Ken, could be very important.
Cale Yarborough also moving by on the high side as Ellis gets right back in there again. Now, Ellis is driving for the same team that won this race, Lenny Pond, a few years ago. And he is showing just absolute determination. For a guy who cut his teeth against Sonny Hutchins and the likes of those short trackers in Virginia, look at how Ellis is performing here today as he pulls up in the second spot and keeps Taylor Yarborough back in third.
He has to give great hope to the short track races around the country, Ken. Many of them have raced with this fella on the Saturday nights, and now they see him up here running with the best in the world and say, hey, maybe it's not as hard as we think.
Now, Dalton, Ron Bouchard is getting into it as well. Car number 47 with a new crew chief here for today's race. A new look on the BB team. And Ron Bouchard, who won it in 1981 in that three of rest finish, back straight away. Here comes Cale. He goes after the number three car of Earnhardt, the yellow and blue car. Earnhardt, Richard Childress, Chevrolet getting past the turn number three. Bottom of the track, Cale Yarborough and Fronette carry the body. Number 44, the Billy Hagan entry. Car chaperoned to the shot by Dale Inman, now into second place and looking very stout through all the qualifying and practice period thus far.
And the car has also looked very strong in recent races. He's been in the picture of the photo finishes in several of the events here at Talladega. He knows how to drive this racetrack. Dale Inman knows how to set the car up to make it go fast.
Four laps have been complete. Just an explosive start to this event as they swap the lead back and forth. Remember, the record. Now here's Bodine cutting through cars. That is Kyle Petty in the number seven car. Ricky Rudd in the 15 and A.J. Boyd in 14, the red car in the backstretch. Here comes Kyle Petty down the inside. Big problems for that team these days. More about that story later in today's live coverage of the Talladega 500. Back with the leaders another time. Yarborough deployed first in the second spot. Labonte, as they come out of turn number four, Earnhardt is still maintaining third. Coming around to complete five laps in the tri-oval.
And Buddy Baker has moved up there in fourth place. He is one of the big winners here at Talladega. He loves this racetrack and the high speed they run here.
Baker is in fourth and is five car lengths back. In fifth is Ron Bouchard, and Ellis has fallen to sixth. But he's not falling much further back than that. And now Bouchard is closing up. You're back with Bill Elliott as he skims through traffic another time. Bill Elliott, who won at Riverside, California, the last race of last year and won at Michigan this year. Here he is right behind Tommy Ellis, darting down into turn number three, up on the 33-degree banking. Pulls about a G and a half right here.
Yeah, there's lots of racing room. You can see Ellis move to the inside of the track where Bill Elliott is staying high, along with Cale Yarborough in the car number 28.
Look at Ellis get in there and shuffle it with these fellas. That's the car number four that Ellis is in on the inside.
It's interesting how we see those cars just bobbling a little bit. It's almost impossible to keep the cars in a straight line when they're running in a draft. They're running against a wall of air right on each side.
Now they're running at just about 200 miles an hour, and you're riding right around this track with Bill Elliott. This incredible speed, inches apart. Bodine, who started in the 28th position, is now up to 19. Bodine, at number 28, is on the chart and cutting through traffic. Now you're back with Richard Petty. There may be a windshield crack in the bottom of Richard Petty's windshield. Car number 43.
Yes, it does look there is a crack there again, and that could be trouble for him later on. There's a tremendous amount of pressure on the windshield at the speed they run here.
As they come down, that might be part of the coating they put on the windshield, but it sure looked like a crack. Back in front of car number three, it is Children, or rather the Childress car, with Earnhardt aboard in that front running position. They've now completed seven laps, working lap number eight, and the shuffle continues. You see those cars take a set and then move over 3 or 4 feet, just as if someone lifted them up and sent them over.
The air circulation will cause that. Now here's Buddy Baker going for the lead. He's a charger, puts his board right out front around Dale Earnhardt.
Down to the inside, Baker, another previous winner of this event, goes to the lead. It's Baker out in front. Earnhardt stays in second, and the third place car is that number 44, the white and blue color. But Bouchard is on the inside and trying to close. As they come to the tri-oval, it's Bouchard on the bottom of the track. He wants a peek at first place.
He has a new crew chief on his car, Wayne Bumgarner, who was with the Diehard team that Bobby Allison drives for, is now the crew chief on the car number 47, and we have seen the results. Just in the last 2 weeks, he has really made the car help to put it up front.
That's the blue car on the bottom side fighting for third right now. The man who won it in 81, and he's falling back just a bit to Labonte, and coming back is Cale Yarborough to fourth. Bouchard falling to fifth. Let's get a word from Benny Parsons for just a moment. Your opinion of these first 8-9 laps.
I tell you what, the first 15 cars did break away from the back cars, but the second pack of 10 cars caught up again. We now have a 25-car draft. And as you see the Ron Bouchard and Bill Elliott, when they try to go to the inside of the racetrack, they have lots of problems. That is not the fast way around right now.
And why?
Well, because as you come off the turn, the car does not accelerate. You bog the car down, or as you come up out of the turn, it takes a lot of horsepower. And up high on the racetrack, you don't use much horsepower.
Again, last year, we had a record 75 lead changes in this race. In the first nine laps, there have already been six lead changes.
Down they come in the front straightaway. Out in front goes Labonte in the 44. Labonte trying for that lead and back on the outside again. Comes number three, Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt right back there in that Richard Childress car. What a job that Childress crew has done this year.
He is a former driver himself, but he knows what it takes to make a fast race car. When he was driving, he didn't have the sponsorship, the bucks behind him to help him run in a first-class manner. He has that now and is proving his ability.
Just fantastic racing, wouldn't you agree, Benny Parsons?
It is. It's great racing. I'm impressed. I'd rather see a race like this from up here than down inside the car. It's
really?
Too nerve-wracking.
Maybe sometimes we'll see a car, we see Labonte down on the inside, which as you say is not the place to be because we're going to see Elliott pull right up on the outside of it in the draft of Cale Yarborough. But it looks like when we see one just zip by another one that he's generated 100 horsepower. It looks easy, but it really isn't.
It really is not that easy. You've got to have everything just right to go by with that surge of speed, man.
Down to the inside, Bouchard knocking off one, knocking off two. The number 47 car getting by Elliott, pulling up again, trying to move in and losing some ground another time as they come to the tri-oval. Down to the track finish line.
It's interesting how we saw him pull up there. He had the momentum going. He had picked up the draft of cars in front of him, but once he got up there to them, hit that wall of air, then we saw him start going backwards. He's down on the inside once again, but it's awfully tough to make a strong run from him.
From Richard Petty's car, looking out the back, and right behind him comes Allison. That is Allison right there, and on the inside you see one of the Junior Johnson cars, Neil Bonnet. Last lap on the leaders was turned at 198.2. We are now working the 12th lap.
Well, A.J. Foyt's not running too well at this point, Ken. He's back in 25th position running by himself on the racetrack, an indication that his car is not handling when he gets in the heavy traffic.
Bill Elliott is running in fifth. Richard Petty pulls himself up into the sixth position. Let's go to Chris Economaki with the story on pit row.
I'm with Glenn Wood, who's Buddy Baker's car. Glenn, some of the laps have been over 200 miles an hour. It's early in the race. Can these engines stand this for 500 miles?
Well, that gear's tall enough to stand it, should be. They'll turn in the neighborhood of 7,800, and they'll be up and down a little bit, but the speed should be in the range with the gear.
You're not worried about it?
No.
Okay, 200 miles an hour, just another day at the race. Back to you, Ken.
Ken, when he said that he had a tall enough gear, that means he has a high gear ratio. Benny, approximately what do they run in these cars now?
Well, the cars today will be running a 3.15 to 1 or a 3.25, which means that the engine turns 3.25 times the rear wheel turning once.
And that, in comparison to a street car, is about the same ratio?
About the same as a street car, right. Some of the street cars today have 2.7 to 2.8, but 10 years ago.
First 10 laps run at a record 197.443 miles an hour. Back with more live coverage of the Talladega 500 after this word from your local station.
This is CBS.
Your transmission tuned up by Atrix now and save $12. For $6.95, can you afford to overlook your transmission any longer? Atrix, clearly the transmission experts.
George, you've got MCI long distance. Think it's right for my business.
MCI? Wall Street's top banks and brokers use it. Five of the big six automakers, nine of the top 10 oil companies, plus hundreds of thousands of other businesses save hundreds of millions of dollars with MCI.
But I'm a small plane.
Planes? Six top airlines use MCI for interstate calls anytime, coast to coast.
Call MCI. We sound better to business.
The Good Samaritan Center in Camden gives emergency food and clothing to those in need. Donations are welcome. Call 609-963-0857.
The Walnut Street Theater celebrates its 175th anniversary with a season of theatrical magic. Subscribe now and get two plays free. Call WALNUT5.
Sunday night sports final with Joe Pellegrino.
We have 20. 20- five cars running in the lead draft. And at this moment, car number three is out in front. It is Dale Earnhardt trying to be the first man in history to win this race 2 years back-to-back. We are in the 16th of the 188 laps. Buddy Baker is in second. Let's get a quick report from Mike Joy.
I'm with Buddy Parrott, Richard Petty's crew chief, and looking through the in-car camera, Buddy, it looks like that windshield might be cracked.
Well, this morning we put a protective coating on the inside of the windshield just to make sure that in case anything flew up and cracked. Okay.
We have a caution on the track for car number 87. In trouble is Randy Baker, the half-brother of Buddy Baker, having a problem, and you see him running very slowly down the back straightaway, and the first caution comes out as the field completes 16 laps.
I believe it's his third Grand National race. As you mentioned, he's the younger brother of Buddy Baker, the son of Hall of Fame member Buck Baker. That's the car number, 87, that Buck Baker ran, and Buck says that this fella has at least as much talent as Buddy Baker has, or perhaps even more. He's very high on this young man. Had a very good qualifying run here at over 195 miles an hour.
The Buick of Randy Baker brings out the first caution flag of the day. Field now working in the 17th lap. Mike Joy giving us that report that apparently it was the coating and not a crack in the windshield on car number 43. You can see the safety car exiting pit road.
I suppose we'll see a lot of the cars come into the pits here. They've run almost a half of a pit stop, almost 50 miles, in other words.
Car number three, Earnhardt, in front in the Talladega 500, ready to make a pit stop. We'll be back with more action in a moment.
Good tossing, Billy.
Still anybody's game.
Good all.
Get some.
Team shitting in the night.
Good all.
I thought you were best at sitting.
That's right. So I gotta save you.
Don't stay out in the sun too long.
Your best deserves the best.
Bud Light?
The less filling light beer with a first name and taste.
Tough day.
Bud Light.
They call him the king because Richard Petty knows what it takes to win.
Going into the last lap, there's no better place to be than in second. Then, if you slingshot at just the right moment, you could be the winner.
Winning, it's a part of men like Richard Petty.
And that winning spirit has helped Union 76 fuel more winners than anyone else. That winning quality rides with you every time you ride out of a Union 76 station.
Go with the spirit.
The winning spirit.
Spirit of 76.
Most guys spend Sunday taking it easy. Not me. When I'm racing the Bandit, there's no taking it easy. So I'm out here early before a race trying to relax. Just me and my scope. Just the paint gives me real tobacco pleasure without lighting up. And that wintergreen flavor's a real winner.
Go smokeless with Skoal or Copenhagen. A pinch is all it takes.
Who's been using my razor?
Mine burns me.
I don't blame your razor. Use my ice blue Aqua Velva.
It turns red hot razor burn to cool comfort. Smooths, too.
My Aqua Velva man.
There's something about an ice blue Aqua Velva man.
Mommy beat Daddy.
I quit.
Yvonne, how do you do it?
Isn't easy. Now Sir Morgan was born, my doctor told me I had iron poor blood. Now I protect myself, eat right, and take Geritol. It's great protection against iron poor blood.
Next, the PGA pros will shoot for the title when play continues at the 33rd Hartford Open. Live coverage on CBS Sports.
Under caution with our live flag-to-flag coverage of the Talladega 500 here on CBS this afternoon. Field is under caution after a blown engine for Randy Baker. Let's take a look at replay and what we saw just a few moments ago out here on pit road. Now, Benny Parsons, that looks like a very busy supermarket on Saturday morning.
Can you imagine that? And, you know, how do you get any reason out of that chaos that you're seeing there? Your tires is every place. And Phil, my brother's right in the middle of the screen right now. He backs up and then tries to go. And I think he's having a problem of some kind. That's a live picture we're seeing. He's out of the race again.
Oh, that's too bad. Running for Rookie of the Year, Phil Parsons, car number 66, having a problem here. He's been in a pretty good squabble with Rusty Wallace, and now Tommy Ellis is running for Rookie of the Year, really getting into it with the McClure car.
They have some excellent rookies this year, probably the best crop of rookies they've had in a long time.
Then it does it look that way from the inside of the automobile when you're on pit road?
Oh, it does. You get in there and somebody pulls in front of you. You can't get out. Or if you're the last one to come down pit road, then you can't get in.
And it seems like an eternity.
It seems like an eternity. There's tires, as we noticed a moment ago on that shot, there's tires laying all in pit road, which is you got to dodge. It's like going to the supermarket and the light poles you got to dodge to get in and out.
And the carts.
And the carts, right.
19 laps complete this time by 50 and a half miles will have been completed in our 500-mile test today on the NASCAR Grand National Tour.
Joe Ruttman had a problem in the pits again. He had the hood up on his car, number 98. He had charged up towards the front and was in that lead pack of cars, but he now has gone a lap down, and Phil Parsons, as we see his car being pushed into the garage area, Mike Joy was there.
That car has lost its drive shaft, Ned, and the rear end. They may have a problem there as well. They're going to fix it and get Phil back in the race for rookie points.
Let's see if we can get a word with Jeff Bodine here. Jeff Bodine, you came from 28 up to 11. Looks like that car is really hitched up today, Jeff.
It is, Ken. It's handling real good. We got up on the outside groove and seem to come to the front pretty fast. We can maintain that all day. We'll be in good shape here. I want to say hi to my boys, Matt and Barry. They're back home. They want to be race car drivers someday. Now they can look and see what their father has to go through every week.
Jeff, this is Ned Jarrett. That fellow right in front of you, Kyle Petty, was coming up through the field with you.
Yeah, Kyle was running good. Neil Binder, Tim Richmond, and Joe Ruttman, we're all running good. We get worked together here, just kind of, you got to pick off these guys in front of you one at a time. It's hard to take a bunch at a time. Just take one at a time. If we can do that, we should be able to get to the front here in this next period.
Good luck to you, Jeff. Now we're going to the pit area. Here's Chris Economaki.
All kinds of excitement down here. Trouble with the cars, and one of Joe Ruttman's pitmen splashed some fluid in his face. He's getting his eyes washed out. Ruttman's car broke a distributor. We've had windshields cracking, drive shafts going bad, distributors breaking, and the race is only 50 miles old. It's going to be one of those days, I think. Back to you, Ken.
Ken, on the drive shaft situation, Benny, it's on a track like this with the high gearing. Sometimes it's awfully easy when you let that jack down, maybe to accelerate too quick, which can get a transmission, an axle, or a drive shaft.
Well, it is, and the clutch that we use on these race cars today is a very small unit, and it has a metallic disc, and it is so responsive that it's either in or out, and they will not take. When you let the clutch out here, the clutch engages so fast that it will just pop a drive shaft out.
Four cars have retired from the event. Grant Adcox is out. Ronnie Thomas from Virginia has retired. Randy Baker, as you just saw. Phil Parsons, they have out, but we believe he's going to try to make an effort to get back in the event. 40 cars starting the event this afternoon, and 20 laps will be complete when they come by this time. They are now estimating attendance at some 94,000 for this race. The leader is that car number 17 that's now pitting, and that is Clark Dwyer, the 20-year-old driver from Colorado Springs, Colorado, in the Roger Hamby car.
But now he comes into the pit, and let's go to the pit to Mike Joy.
I'm with Dick Hutcherson, co-crew chief for A.J. Foyt. A.J.'s been running along in the middle of the pack. Is he just feeling things out, or is the car okay?
Well, we're just letting the cars get strung out a little bit. He said everything feels perfect, and we had a good pit stop then. We'll see if we can't stay up there now.
When you're running a series against fellas who drive this circuit 30 times a year, is it tough to come in and just run four or five races and keep up on all the innovations?
You're right. When you come down here and run NASCAR, you better bring your lunch, because it's an all-day job to beat these guys.
Good luck today.
Hey, A.J.
Back upstairs.
There is A.J. Foyt getting set for the start. Car number 14.
That fellow, that Dick Hutcherson that Mike Joy was talking to, was a pretty fair chauffeur himself, and he came from Iowa.
You were fenders with him a few times.
Oh, boy, many times. In fact, I believe he's the best dirt track racer that I ever ran against in stock cars.
Dick Hutcherson. Now, car number 14, originally out of Keokuk, wasn't he? Wasn't he
yes,
another
he was.
One of those Keokuk stars?
I think that the state of Iowa has more racetracks than any other state in the Union, and they're all dirt. So they got some good experience there.
20 laps are now complete, 53 and 2-tenths of a mile. 13 lead changes in 20 laps among seven drivers have been recorded thus far in our CBS Live flag-to-flag coverage of the 16th annual Talladega 500. Now, as we line up, Bobby Allison is on the point. Neil Bonnet is in second. Dale Earnhardt is in third. Richard Petty is in fourth. All four previous winners of this event. There's Terry Labonte, line fifth. Lap cars down on the inside as we get ready. Sterling Marlins, number 95, bottom of the track. And with him comes Joe Ruttman, a lap down. How does that work on a restart, Benny Parsons? With those lap cars down, it really gives you a chance to tighten up and go for it.
Well, it gives you a chance to get that lap back. Like Joe Ruttman, his car is as good as any car here, but yet he had a distributor problem. He's now a lap down. Under the rules, he's able to pull down on the inside and race with the leaders, and if possible, get in front of the leaders to get the caution flag, and therefore he can make up a lap.
Start watching the restart from Richard Petty in fourth place. Six is Cale. Seventh right now is the Melling car, Bill Elliott. Going eighth on the restart is Buddy Baker. In the ninth position is Mike Alexander. Greg Sachs is in tenth as they come back to the line. Running 11th is Tim Richmond. 12th is Bouchard. In the 13th position is Kyle Petty. And in 14th, that car number 5 of Jeff Bodine. And they're immediately going to work and getting around Sterling Marlin is Joe Ruttman. He wants that lap back. He's had a lot of misfortune this year. And a very good race driver. Richard Petty tagging right along with him as they hit the back straightaway. You are with Richard Petty going for his 201st victory here today at the world's fastest racing oval. They're the leaders. As they swap them around up in front, it is now Bonnet to lead, and dropping into that second spot comes the Dale Earnhardt team. Boy, look at that car settle as it goes over some of the rough part of the track.
Earnhardt's car looks very strong in the early going here. Of course, he qualified in the first position, and to me, Ben, it looks the strongest that I've seen it on a super speedway, even though he ran second in the Daytona 500 this year.
Allison back on the inside.
He's more competitive today than he has been, Ben. You're right.
Allison back on the inside, number 22, right back in there, thrusting that car by three machines as they come out of turn number two. Bobby Allison knocks on the door another time.
And the fans here are just loving it because Bobby Allison and Neil Bonnet, the two cars that side by side with Neil Bonnet, are only 50 miles from here. Ewingtown, Alabama, and they got a lot of fans here today.
Alabama gang going for it, and here comes Elliott mixing it up now. He's right up there, inches away from Bobby Allison's car at over 195 miles an hour. As they just sashay a little off turn number four.
Absolutely amazing at how close they can run together. When President Reagan was at Firecracker 400 a few weeks ago, he was awed by the fact that they could run that close together at speeds of upwards of 200 miles an hour.
All right, the Talladega Freight, the Talladega Express, wheels down out of the tri-oval. Just an incredibly fantastic competitive race here this afternoon on CBS from the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Bill Elliott goes back on the inside, and Allison tries to work high on the back straightaway. There you see Petty line four, actually line third, because 98 is a lap car.
And now Ruttman has worked his way up there right behind Dale Earnhardt, so he's in position if another caution can come out to get back in the lead lane.
Really rocket off turn number four, and you can see those cars picking and set, getting bounced around as they come through there in this tremendous grab. Benny Parsons, you get actually lifted out there. It looks like those cars are floating.
They do. The car just, they don't really float, but they move around. There is so much air currents caused by the other cars, it just simply moves you around. There's nothing you can do. And you know, the thing that I want to impress upon these fans watching today, Ken, is these cars are literally, they are actually running 200 miles an hour, bumper to bumper and side by side.
3,700-pound car. Here goes Cale on the outside.
He is strong also. No surprise, though, at 202 miles an hour qualifying. Moves right up on the outside of Joe Ruttman, and Petty coming right with him, too. In the draft, Bobby Allison right behind Petty.
Darrell Walter back 28th on the restart. And he's trying to move his. Well, look at Yarborough just explode out from behind, drops to the bottom of the track, and in the tri-oval, it is Cale Yarborough, who has never won this race. He's won 81 Grand National races, but never this one.
Benny Parsons, there are not many racetracks that you can make that kind of a radical move at the speed that they're running.
No, I tell you what, this racetrack is very forgiving for as fast as you do run. It really is. But also, when you have trouble, you hit hard, as hard here as any racetrack on the circuit.
Benny Parsons can attest to that. Crashing at some 190 miles per hour. What a testimony the way those cars are going, because you just destroyed that car number 55.
I really did, Ken. And, you know, once the smoke settled and the car stopped, I crawled out of the car and walked away from it. And that is a testimony to Cliff champion Leo Jackson, my friend.
But you spent the night in the hospital. How do you feel today?
I feel fine. I really didn't feel that well. I thought it was just my own benefit. I should spend the night so they could closely observe what was going on.
That's That's why Benny Parsons is with us, not starting ninth and not in the thick of this fray. Ronnie Thomas has come back on the track. And an oil leak, lap number 7. He's come back out here fighting for points. Cale is first. Earnhardt is second. Richard Petty comes up on the outside for third. Petty is back into it. Here comes Allison. And down to the inside. Look at Earnhardt struggling to go back by Cale Yarborough. And it will be Earnhardt in the first place at turn 3.
Petty had a notion to go with him, then decided that he'd pull up on Cale and follow him. But Earnhardt was the fast one at that point.
Front 3. Front 4. 5. 6. Make it a dozen. Make it 2 dozen. All together down in the triangle another time. Here's Richard Petty taking a look at Cale Yarborough on the high side this time. Underneath the starter stand and on the inside, here comes Baker.
Baker is strong. And as we mentioned, well, and he touches Cale Yarborough. They both keep control.
How do you do? Baker right there. Cale is not the man to touch.
Look at Baker's car, how squirrely it is as he gets down the mixed up air down on the inside. When we say squirrely, of course, that's the car is moving back and forth.
Better than 200 miles an hour into turn number 3. They are side by side. You are inside Richard Petty's car. Here's a move by Elliott.
It's said that the Ford cars are very good for drafting because of the design of it. Benny, you've had experience with both kinds of cars drafting at these high speeds.
I haven't driven one of the new Thunderbirds that we're seeing out here today, Ned, but just looking at the car and understanding aerodynamics, it looks like that it would be one of the better cars.
Petty moves in, looking like he's on a busy interstate, the Long Island Expressway, just dodging between cars at 40, 45 miles an hour, except this is 200 miles an hour at the world's fastest oval, and there is the battle for the lead, all of it.
You know, Ken, people would say there's no way these cars are running 200 miles an hour, but they are especially prepared automobiles. They're not stock cars. They're not Chevrolets and Fords and Chryslers that you can go buy. They're worked on and spent many, many hours developing these cars for this speed we're seeing today.
And many, many thousands of dollars.
And many dollars.
29 laps will be complete this time. Often the scene in the early going are big express trains like this at Talladega.
That's Bobby Allison's crew chief, Gary Nelson, keeping his eye on what Allison's doing. Of course, he's right in the thick of that battle.
Earnhardt stays first. The number 28 car, Cale Yarborough, maintaining second. The rest of the field tagging along. Richard Petty in third, and here's an Elliott. Elliott back into it with Terry Labonte on the inside of the 44 car, the blue car.
Now with Labonte coming up on the inside, Ken Baker's had a problem down on the inside by himself, but now maybe he can hook up with Labonte and be able to move on up as two working together.
Two cars on the inside, will that stabilize the front car, Benny Parsons?
It will help the front car somewhat, but it is not as good as the cars on the outside, Ken.
30 laps, 80 miles, 79.8 miles complete, this time by. In the 16th annual, live coverage of the Talladega 500 to the stripe, Earnhardt perseveres in first place, right there in second. And now you're back another time with Bill Elliott and that Ford Thunderbird. Look at the chewing gum along there. You can tell this is a big, long race. I think he has at least 5 chews for this one, Ned.
He figures one for every 100 miles, I guess. You can see his right foot as he goes up and down on the gas. He can't run full throttle, Benny Parsons, around even though they're running 200 miles an hour.
Well, that's right. Not with the cars in front of him, because the draft is so important. And it helps that car so much that he's able to literally back off the accelerator and still run 200 miles an hour.
Richard Petty going for it. Richard Petty pulling up for the lead. 22 cars, the lead pack. Richard Petty is trying to take that first spot. They are side by side coming through the fourth turn, down into the tri-oval. Petty, bottom side. Dale Earnhardt high. Cale Yarborough right behind, followed by Bobby Allison in fourth. Back in front goes Earnhardt.
It would take an awfully strong engine to be able to pass down on the inside.
Richard's going to wish he hadn't done that before this is over, I'll tell you.
1 through 22. 22 cars are 2 seconds apart. 22 cars, 6 seconds apart. Rather, 2 seconds, 2.06 seconds.
Running very close. Now, you see, Petty has had to fall back in line. And then you said he's going to wish that he hadn't done that. He's back in fifth instead of battling for the lead. What happened when he went
out? Well, he gets on the bottom side of the racetrack, and there just isn't, you just don't have enough power to get up off those turns on the bottom of the racetrack, particularly when you've got this string of cars that are drafted on the outside and leave you there by yourself. You've got to have someone to draft with if you're going to do that. He may be able to do this in 10 laps or 15 laps when the tires are hot and the cars can't handle. Maybe he can run down it. But right now they've got fresh tires. Everybody's handling well.
Further back in the field, in that ninth position, is Kyle Petty. In tenth is Tim Richmond. Running 11th is Lake Speed. In the 12th position right now, there stands Neil Bonnet. And going 13th is Tommy Ellis. In the 14th position is Ricky Rudd. And running 15th, back up to 15th, comes Darrell Walters, making a great charge. Average speed through 30 laps, 159.6 miles per hour. That is not a record. Here's a word from Mike Joy.
I'm in the midst of the lead car, Dale Earnhardt. Each team keeps its own score chart of the individual laps as they come.
Got a crash at turn number four, and that is the car number two that's being driven by Elliot Forbes Robinson today. Elliot Forbes Robinson has socked the wall at turn number four.
He has lost an engine, Ken. I would see. You see the smoke coming out of the exhaust pipes? That means that's water that's gotten in the exhaust pipes, and they're so hot that we're seeing steam come out of there.
And when the engine lets go, water all gets under those rear wheels. You don't have much control.
That's exactly what happened to me the other day in Friday when I crashed, was I blew an engine, which caused the problem.
Former Trans Am champion Elliot Forbes Robinson has brought out the second caution of the afternoon in the 32nd lap when the crash took place. Field now working in lap number 33. Caution flag in the hand of Harold Kinder, and let's see if we can discern anything from what happened up there in turn number four with this replay.
He's already in the slide. Apparently, the engine let go as he started into turn three. The oil got under the wheel and just sent him spinning around and around, and now he comes down off of the high banking, going backwards, of course. See the front end of the car bashed in as he got into the wall very hard.
The Robert Harrington, car number two, formerly one of the Jim Stacy stable cars. Elliot Forbes Robinson taking a savage beating in the fourth turn here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Here is a report from Mike Joy.
Dale Earnhardt is on pit road. Richard Childress, Kurt Schaubergine of the team have gotten a real good pit service this year, and it's helped Earnhardt to the point standing championship. They're going all the way around to change four tires. Let's go down pit road to Chris Economaki.
And national champion Bobby Allison is doing the same thing. He's already had his outside tires changed. Tires are very important here at Talladega. Not only to have the fresh ones on, but to have the right diameter. The difference in diameter is called in racing the stagger. And if the stagger is right, a car can really go. And if it's wrong, the driver is in real trouble. Back to you, Ken.
It's pit road, and the action is for the moment. Waiting for a report on Elliot Forbes. Richard Petty is coming to a halt down at the exit of pit road, number 43. There you see it. You're in the car now. And he's turning things off, and he may have cooked something on number 43.
There is smoke coming out from underneath the car, and so I think something has happened to the engine.
It really is. And he was right up there in the thick of the battle. No indication when he was running under the green that he had problems. But here, after making a pit stop, just heading back out. Something wrong with Richard Petty's Pontiac. And you can see Richard now reaching down to unbuckle his safety equipment, now taking the window screen loose. So apparently that's going to be all.
Back up there, yeah.
Richard Petty, can we get a word with you? We're going to try to get a word from him in just a moment here.
He told his crew to try to push it back up there, so yeah, maybe he thinks
he's walking away from it, so that's
Elliot Forbes Robinson. Richard Petty, this is Ken Squire at CBS.
Yeah, go ahead.
What happened?
Well, I think the transmission come out of it. I just left the pit in first gear, and when I shifted to second, everything broke loose, and I think the back of the transmission probably broke.
Can it be repaired and get you back out here for points?
According to how big a hurry they want to get in. Yeah, it could be repaired. We'll see what's going on after we get it back up to the garage here and see.
All right, sir. Richard Petty, number 43. See if we can see. There's when he was coming out. And as he came out, going down pit road here.
And he said it's
something broke right there.
Yeah, and you can see that smoke. Yeah, and apparently it did burst the transmission or something. If it had been a drive shaft, we wouldn't see the grease and the oil come out of it.
That's correct.
Car number 43 sapped its strength for just a moment. They're going to do some repair work and try to get Richard Petty back in this event. And this car is making its last appearance before it becomes a museum piece. Richard was kidding about that. He said they ought to put me in there with it. Averaging more than one official lead change every two laps thus far in the running of the Talladega 500. Live today on CBS Sports. 35 laps have been completed. Stand by for more of the competition and speed from the Alabama International Motor Speedway.
When athlete's foot makes you itch, 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 and you itch, and you itch, and you twitch, 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 ditch the itch, 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 ditch the itch, itch, itch with Absorbine Junior.
Absorbine Junior stops itch in seconds, kills fungus on contact, helps heal athlete's foot. So when you have athlete's foot,
ditch the itch, 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 ditch the itch, itch, itch with Absorbine Junior.
Ditch the itch with Absorbine Junior in liquid or powder.
There's more for your life.
Last year, while you were deciding which home computer to take home, Sears bolted on more than a million muffins. While you were trying on the latest Goolagong activewear, Sears sold over 9 million tires. And while you were checking out Sears' open home collection, we replaced more batteries than anyone else in America.
36 laps, 95 miles have been completed as you see the remains of car number two, the Elliott Forbes Robinson car from which he walked away, being brought into the garage area, and Richard Petty's car. Wrong way, Richard coming up Pitt Road here as they hustle it back, trying to get that car in for additional work. Now, two cars have broken drivetrains today, and we'll ask either Ned Jarrett or Benny Parsons. Here at Alabama, that's pretty critical, getting off Pitt Road as much as the activity on the racetrack.
It is very critical, because running 200 miles an hour on the racetrack, sometimes you come into the pit, you lose the concept of speed, and then especially when you try to accelerate and go back out, Benny, which puts a lot of extra strain on the driver's train.
It really does. And, you know, there's always the controversy here. What gear do you run, a open rear end like what they use in street cars, or a locked rear end that both wheels pull? And a locked rear end is better for leaving the pits because you have both rear tires pulling, but it's worse on the transmission and drive shaft, because as you let the clutch out, you have all that power going and you don't have any tire slippage. And when the tire's spinning, that simply is saving the clutch and the transmission.
Richard Petty's car being pushed back. We're going to try and get some work done on that car in the drivetrain and get him back into action. 37 laps have now been completed, and as they are lining up for this restart taking place when they come by this time, we'll have car number 75, Dave Marcus, in the lead. Let's go to Mike Joy.
When the caution came out, Ken, we were talking to Richard Childress, who's the crew chief on what was the lead car at the time, Dale Earnhardt. A lot goes on here on pit road between pit stops. They chart every lap of the race, and you can see the lap times below 48 seconds. The first seven laps of this race run at over 200 miles an hour. And when Earnhardt went back to the lead on lap 24, that was also a 200-plus mile-an-hour lap. Another crewman keeps track of gas mileage. Another measures tire circumference, as they have to adjust air pressure to keep that stagger that's so important in the right perspective that Chris Economaki talked about. Richard Childress, are you surprised that this race is so fast that we've had nine laps of this race over 200 miles an hour?
Well, not really. With the weather conditions today, we anticipated running over 200, and we made a couple of changes this morning for the weather.
You're the point standing leaders, but you guys really need a win.
Yeah, we need a win. We'll hope it'll come today, or if not, our time's coming. It's really competitive this year.
Well, they're up front and in position to do so. Back to you, Cap.
All right. Here's how they line up as they come down on the start. It'll be Dave Marcus out in front, the Raymock team, number 75 for first. In the second now is Neil Bonnett. Running third on the restart will be the car number 9, Bill Elliott. And moving up to fourth is Harry Gant, who won at Pocono, Pennsylvania in a 500 mile there just last Sunday.
Phil Parsons is back in the action now, Ken, even though several laps down.
Ron Bouchard is in fifth, and on the start, Bouchard started to slip back a little, then picks it back up and goes after them. The leader for the moment, Dave Marcus, started from the pole and won this race, this Talladega 500.
Right on his back bumper is Neil Bonnett, who drove this car number 75 last year for Bob Rahilly and Butch Fox, who owned the Raybach team. So he knows what he's got to pass. He won several races in that car in 1983.
Now there's Bonnett right there in that second spot, and they get just a little bit of breathing room, but the freight train is about to overhaul them. Here's Elliott back in third. 39 laps completed, 188 this time by. Marcus out in front. Native of Wisconsin, staying in first, an Alabama driver in second. And here comes Elliott, the Georgia driver in the Ford Thunderbird, goes down to the bottom of the track, and look how easy that car moves through, Ned.
He wasted no time whatsoever. He just talked about it, moved right on the inside, and flew right around it. Wouldn't surprise me to see him move around. Marcus going into turn three. Let's see if he does. He pulls out to make the pass. Here he goes.
Here's Elliott going for the lead another time, and Marcus relegated to second position. Elliott puts the Ford back up in the front running position. It's Bill Elliott now in the lead. Just an amazing performer, this youngster. Elliott trying to lead, I believe, for the first time in the race, Ned.
Yes, he's been right in the thick of the battle all afternoon, but this is the first time that he has led. Now, maybe he's led at some portion on the track, but the official times are right when they come by the start-finish line, and that time he did get it in, so he is the official leader of that particular lap.
Back in the sixth position there is Jody Ridley. Jody Ridley, the Cumberland car beginning to show some strength out here. Good racer, former rookie of the year, and he drove for Junie Donlevy, the number 84. Right side of your screen trying to make a move. The 84 car, and Baker gets underneath it.
Baker wastes no time in getting back up towards the front. His car looks awfully strong here today, too.
Lots of rumors that this is Baker's last year with the Wood Brothers.
There was a meeting going on this morning with Kyle Petty of the Wood Brothers. There's been rumors that he might go to that car next year.
The story is that Kyle Petty has an arrangement with his sponsor for 3 years, and he might well take that somewhere besides from his own grandfather's shop.
The rumors here this week have been awfully strong that Kyle might leave the Petty Enterprises. Of course, Richard Petty left Petty Enterprises last winter and drives for the Mike Curb Racing Associates. And if Kyle did leave, don't know what might happen to that.
Elliott now is second place here in Ed. Benny Parsons.
Buddy Baker is driving like a man possessed out there. I think that he's heard all these rumors, and I think he's trying to get himself in position for next year right now, Ned.
He's listening to that, Jared. Here's Elliott now up, making a shot for the lead.
Neil bodied on the inside, being pushed by Buddy Baker, but now Baker decides, well, maybe I ought to move up here behind Bill Elliott. He seems to be the strongest at this point and get some help from his Ford buddy.
Elliott was the 10th different leader in the event.
Well, then he says, we'll just make it three deep going into turn, body, and Elliott.
It's Baker. Look at Baker come through and Bouchard. Now, there's the move that gave Bouchard the win here in 1981. Blue top, red bottom on car number 47, a car that just glided down across the track right to the bottom and picked up a couple of spots. So Baker's now first, and Ron Bouchard is in second, the Pittsburgh, Massachusetts ace who cut his teeth in modified racing in the New England area. Now back into second place, and he has an excellent brother coming along. Kenny Bouchard is looking stronger every year.
He runs very strong in the modified circuit up in the Northeast, where Ronnie Bouchard got most of his experience.
Hello, here he comes again. Dale Earnhardt trying to be the first man in history. Ooh, just slides in there. And look at Bouchard have to work number 47 as he almost overrode car number 3, taking that spot. How about that, Benny Parsons?
I tell you what, that 3 car, Dale Earnhardt, is extremely strong today. He is the strongest I've seen him all year, because he was third in line then going down the back straightaway, pulled out and almost passed the front 2 cars. And at Talladega, that's very difficult to do.
Takes some horsepower to do it, and also the car's got a handle when you get in the turn. Now you see Elliott has already been pushed back to the 5th position.
There's Jeff Bodine right in there behind Bobby Allison. And on the inside is the Terry Labonte car, Bill Parsons, number 66, back on the track and scrambling. At 40 laps, the average speed 147.153 miles per hour. And we have completed 43 laps to date. 114 miles are down. Here's Bodine underneath Bobby Allison.
Coming up on late speed in car number 1 on the outside. Now, Bodine got some help from Tim Richmond, who we see up in front in the red car down on the inside of the track. But now, Allison gets the momentum coming up behind late speed. Graf played such an important role in making your passes here.
Swapping positions, officially, they only count lead changes at the start-finish line. You can see there's wholesale changes of positions going on. Kyle Petty is in. Looks like a heating problem on car number 7.
Tough luck. He was running very strong. He had come from 26th position up to about 11th before the first caution. But now Kyle in the pits, ruining any chances he might have of winning this race.
Lost almost his entire pit crew. What, 5 of them were fired? Let's go to Mike Joy. Quick word.
Ken, they're just flooding that car with water. It is indeed overheating. They're not sure of the reason, but anything they can cool off, they're going to, and try to get it back in the race for points. The leaders go by, and Kyle will go a lap down.
New leader on the racetrack. Whoop, take it back. Ron Bouchard headed for just about 6 seconds, and bang, there goes Buddy Baker right back into first. Bouchard said hello. I think he headed at the line. He may be credited, Bouchard, with leading for a minute. That's not the story, according to our statistician, Bob Blackford. He led, but not where it counted. Baker back in first, Earnhardt in the second, Bouchard in third, Kaley Armour on the 28th car, on the outside in fourth, then Bill Elliott in fifth. Here's Chris Economak.
We spoke about stagger a little bit ago. That's the difference in circumference from inside wheel to the outside wheel. And that dimension was always measured with a tape measure. It cost $3 or $4. But now a tool has been made to measure. It's a $150 stagger master. And they just put it on here like this and move it up, and they get the reading. A quarter of an inch difference from the outside to the inside makes a great deal of difference on the racetrack. Back to you, Ken.
Leaders now down into turn number one. Baker first. And Earnhardt on the outside, getting caught up as they go into the back straightaway. Another time, Bouchard is there. Ron Bouchard fighting his way back up, trying to take another shot, almost tagging the car as they head down the back straightaway of the world's fastest racing oval, the Alabama International Motor Speedway.
450 degrees. That's how hot parts of your car's engine can get, even in ordinary driving.
Watch how heat and stress can break apart your oil's protective molecules. That's motor oil breakdown. STP Oil Treatment's heat-activated molecules fight motor oil breakdown, fortifying your oil with extra lubricants and anti-wear agents.
Get extra protection. Fight motor oil breakdown with STP Oil Treatment.
STP.
Your car care company.
Sorensky.
Murphy,
you're Sorensky.
Your dog meat,
Sorensky. You guys getting the hang of this?
We got your best.
Bud Light. Your best deserves the best.
Bud Light.
The less filling light beer with a first name and taste.
Sorensky's got some moves, huh?
Bud Light.
Unleashes the new 2000 Sunbird Turbo. One of the world's most technically advanced turbos. It pumps in huge quantities of air and pumps out 150 horsepower when you need it, when you want it. Agile, responsive. Oh, yeah. 2000 Sunbird Turbo. Only from Pontiac.
We build excitement. Pontiac.
Working out, sweating. Gives me the edge. Afterwards, I want to feel dry and odor-free all day. SpeedStick antiperspirant gives me an edge, too. SpeedStick's the wide stick. Goes on dry for man-size protection. Whatever game you're in, the wide stick gives you the edge.
SpeedStick super dry antiperspirant.
By Menin.
Shaving's rough on sensitive skin, but aftershave skin conditioner soothes.
Sensible care for sensitive skin. After.
By Menin.
12 auto racing champions will test their driving skill in identically prepared cars in the final event in the International Race of Champions Series in 2 weeks on CBS Sports.
Working down toward the 50th lap of the Talladega 500, 16th annual. Last lap at an average speed of 200.3 miles per hour. And the man on the point is this man, number 21, Buddy Baker, with Cale Yarborough currently in the second position. Completed 50 laps as they come by this time. 133 miles have been completed on this 2.6 mile track. Next motorsports event on CBS. August 11th, the International Race of Champions final round from the Michigan International Speedway. Here's Cale going into second. That's Saturday, August 11th. Live flag-to-flag covers with three onboard cameras. Benny Parsons, how about that one?
Well, I tell you, I think everybody has been kind of feeling each other out as we've been going along through the first three races. But they're going to pay the money after August 11th. And it's time to get serious.
$150,000 to win International Race of Champions this year. Lead change once again. Give it back to Cale Yarborough, number 28. An amazing Waddell Wilson prepared car out in front. Attrition now stands at six. A.J. Foyt has just retired, and so is Joe Ruttman's number 98. Ruttman and Foyt have retired from the event. Let's take a look at who is out of this race as we watch Cale Yarborough on the point. There you see the cars that have come out. Elliott Forbes Robinson, the heaviest victim here, crashing hard in turn number four. He walked away from that incident. Petty, they're working on his car. Clutch gone on Grant Adcox. He may come back. Randy Baker, no hopes for him today. We'll update the story here at 50 laps. We've had 10 different leaders, and the lead has been swapped 25 times. Just amazing, Mitchell.
It really is. The average speed, of course, reduced by the caution flag that we've had. Now let's go to 10th and back joint.
Well, Ned, a minute ago, we showed you how the teams keep lap charts. Here's another way to do it. Kyle Petty's team has a personal computer on pit road. It charts the number of laps in the race, the number of laps he's run, his lap speed, and how long it's been since he made a fuel stop. The computer's great, but they still keep the handheld chart as a backup.
Last lap at 199.01 miles per hour. Back straight away. Lead car is about to be challenged once again. It's Yarborough on the outside and down on the inside. Here comes Buddy Baker in a rush at over 200 miles an hour. He takes another glimpse of first place. Here's Chris Economaki.
They talk about the high cost of racing. Well, one hidden cost is a replacement windshield, about $100. This is taken out of Lake Speed's car a little bit ago. Would you believe that this windshield was changed in under a minute? It's interesting to know that the windshield glass doesn't fly. They're specially made. They have a layer of plastic inside, and the glass is held to it with a glue. A safety precaution, another expense. Back to you, Ken.
A crash. I believe that may be Buddy Arrow. It's number 90, Richard Brooks' car. Richard Brooks, former winner of this event, has crashed. The 1973 winner, his Ford, the Junie Donlevy car, crashed just at the start-finish line and has landed about 800 feet beyond it.
We see a lot of smoke coming from it, Ken. It's hard to tell. Although we do see smoke coming from the exhaust pipe, and as Benny Parsons mentioned earlier, that's an indication that something let go inside the engine of that car, and that perhaps caused the spin.
That happened in the 52nd lap. Lap number 52.
Brooks is the 1969 Rookie of the Year on the Grand National Circuit and is the only driver in today's race who participated in their inaugural event here in 1969. He drove his own Plymouth and finished fifth in the wake of the infamous driver's boycott of that first race.
He was running 19th, and there you see the car breaking away in the tri-oval. Back end goes into the wall, rotates, slams the front end. He once rolled about 12, 13 times in the back straightaway here. Here he is just across the start-finish line, and he'll end up down to the grass.
Very fortunate, Ken, that he didn't hit the wall any harder than he did, and now the car scoots down into the grass area, and that's where it rests right now.
He is still sitting in the car and waiting for some assistance. Richard Brooks in car number 90, California native. Now beginning to unstrap. Here's Benny Parsons.
Well, that's really and truly the safest place to begin, because those cars that are going by on the racetrack, they look like they're going 50 miles an hour, but in fact, they're probably running 125 miles an hour, so you need to stay in the car.
We'll be back with more live coverage of this, the 1984 Talladega 500, after this word from your local station.
This is CBS.
Let's look at some of these areas, Kay.
Your tri-state area Dodge dealers have a problem. We can't wait for the end of the year for our end-of-the-year clearance.
No problem.
Because Dodge cars and trucks are selling so fast. Dodge Omnis, Chargers, Ram Tough trucks, Caravans, Aries, Convertibles, and the sensational Dodge Daytona. They're going fast. The before the end-of-the-year clearance.
You better get there before the one you want is gone.
No problem?
No problem.
Betty, stop fiddling.
I'm not. I'm scratching. My shirt's not soft like before. And where's that fresh smell?
Well, I just washed it. You didn't use Downy. There's a big difference without the softener.
Only Downy combines skin-loving softness with April freshness. Makes static cling almost disappear.
Tonight's the night.
Mom, it's softer. And it smells good.
They sure notice when you use Downy. And I notice the smile.
April Fresh Downy.
Eagles versus Lions, Saturday at 7.
This CBS Sports Special, the Talladega 500, is sponsored by AC Delco, the smart parts. STP Corporation, around the track, around the world, wherever performance counts, STP is there. And by Commodore Computer. It's not how little you pay, but how much you get for the money.
The longest walk in sports is not from the bullpen. The longest walk in sports is when you've tried your very best you take that long walk away from a car that you had so much hope that would change your destiny. Richard Brooks, car number 90, originally out of Porterville, California, and a great favorite. Now, after he crashed, he left some debris on the track, and Jody Ridley, then running in sixth, overran it, Ned, and there's the result. He blew a tire, and he's had some problems.
He did blow a tire as he went across the start-finish line, hitting some of the debris off of Brooks' car. Tough break for him, just an innocent victim of circumstances.
Joe Ruttman lost an engine. A.J. Foyt, they say, lost his power steering. That's an update on those two stories today. We are at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. There is a crowd near 100,000 here today. But the story of American motorsports may best be told by tracks away from the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Chris Economaki filed this report.
If you're young and withered in this country, surely you've been touched by Saturday night fever. In one section of these United States, it could be a disco. Another section, a rock concert. Perhaps a night at the movies or a high school football game. But if you're from the red clay states of the South, dotted with quarter-mile and fifth-mile racetracks, Saturday night fever is a stock car track.
Fun and exciting.
Yeah, it's Saturday racing.
Everybody comes out and brings their mothers and daddies and kids and nephews and relatives and friends. Anybody wants to come.
After a strenuous week of peanut and soybean farming, it's a pleasant stroll. And like everything else, prices have gone up. But it's a wonderful night out for the entire family, for the grandfather right on down to the grandchildren. When the green flag drops, it makes it worth it all because it's competition they come to see.
This is where it all began, and dirt is where it all started, and that's where the competition is.
This is the toughest place in the world to win a race. I'd like to see Bobby, Kel, and Darrell come over here and run.
Yes, sir. Let them go. Watch them. Down the front straightaway, watch this car one on the inside. He'll peek on the inside. Can he do it? Watch them down the back straightaway.
They wean them young. And it's the competition that counts here, not how much the car costs or who the sponsor is. It's the driver from my town beating the driver from your town on the high banks of this red clay track.
As far as wheel-to-wheel and side-by-side stuff, it's pretty hard to beat this.
This is tough, yeah. I guarantee you. It's every man for himself and then some.
And the racing is close and fast and sometimes a little bit rough as the fans watch to see whether their man wins, and then now and then the engines start to go. It's a costly sport. You can't win them all.
I guess anybody would like to go Grand National, you know, but I like the dirt, too, you know. I enjoy it.
Everybody that does this has a dream of racing over there, but very few of them come through.
It's a lot easier to dream on a full stomach. Souvenirs and something to eat and drink are part and parcel. It all adds up for the economy here at the Talladega Short Track.
Brings in a lot of revenue, a lot of out-of-town drivers race here for our special events and even on a weekly basis, and we've been very fortunate to draw good crowds here at Talladega Short Track.
What it all adds up to is big business. For every year, more than 55 million Americans buy tickets to auto races, making it the largest non-betting spectator sport. And those numbers don't come from the Alabama International Motor Speedway down the street, Indianapolis or Daytona, but from the more than 1,000 little raceways that dot this countryside, like the Talladega Short Track.
Back on the other side of the street, at the Alabama International Motor Speedway, a tribute to all those short trackers across America who make this, the Super World Series of Racing, what it is. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Well, Dick Brooks, what brought that about out there, that whirligig on the track?
Well, you know, we were in a position where if we were going to make a showing, we had to do it like that, you know?
No, seriously.
We lost something in the engine, I don't know, and it, I was doing pretty good with it, and I pushed the clutch in, and then it just slid out from under me, it had to be something in the bottom end because it was a lot of oil, so. But I'd forgotten how far those things slide, man.
What would go through your mind you're twirling like that?
Well, just trying to, you know, make sure that you got some sort of idea which direction you're going in and try to steer away from anything. I know when I turned all the way around and I seen I was going to hit the wall in the back, then the next thought was don't hit the inside wall. So I let the car turn around and then lifted the brakes a little bit. When it got going straight, I pushed it back down. And it stayed straight, then it didn't hit anything else. So sometimes it's a lot of luck, but it worked that time.
You look okay? Any sore spots?
No. I didn't. I barely hit. It just, we were lucky. The Lord was with us, I guess.
Okay, better luck to you next time. But now, Pedro, to Mike George.
Well, Joe Ruttman, Randy Baker, Dick Brooks, and this fella in the garage area. Richard, any chance of getting this car back in the race?
Well, we're trying to. They had to change transmission. We busted the tail shaft right after we made a pit stop, and as I went out and changed gears, we busted the tail shaft on the thing, and all the grease runs out, and it starts bobbling. So they think they can get it back in. In fact, they're almost ready to get it back in. Now we've got to determine if we're so far behind, we might be better not to wear the car out and take chances on, getting in more trouble.
Well, even though you're not in the running for the win, there's such a big pot of gold at the end of the season, you've got to get out there and run for points if you can.
I think that's one thing they're looking at. You know, as far as points standing at the end of the season, one or two positions can mean, a bunch of bucks. So even though you don't make it here, you might can make it at the end of the year.
Richard Petty trying to get back in the race. Elsewhere in the garage area, A.J. Foyt is out of the event. And this is Elliott Forbes Robinson's car, or rather, what's left of it. If you'd taken that wrap in your passenger car, that front bumper would probably be up somewhere around the windshield. Now, they're not trying to get this car back in the race, but they'll try to get it ready to race at Atlanta in November. Back upstairs.
58 laps have been completed, 154 miles. 26 cars are still in the lead lap of the 1984 Talladega 500, live today on CBS.
A little loss of control here could ruin your whole day.
Test pilot Chuck Yeager for AC Delco.
Even on the highway, I stay on top of my car with the new Delco Performer shock absorber. Its sealed gas cell eliminates air bubbles and provides a constant cushion in lab tests and on the highway. It's the only shock your car will ever need.
Never wait for trouble. Get the Delco Performer.
Call 800-AC-DELCO for a retailer near you.
A day in the life of a Commodore 64. Commodore 64. Once you get it, you'll wonder how you got along without it.
My dandruff's back and I just shampooed.
Stop worrying and take your medicine. Tegrin shampoo. Preventive medicine that helps control dandruff 3 days.
Bad dandruff?
And I shampooed today.
Stop worrying and take your medicine. Tegrin. Preventive medicine that helps control dandruff 3 days. Ordinary shampoos just wash away flakes. Tegrin's proven medicine helps prevent dandruff, itching, and flaking.
Nice hair.
Took my medicine. Tegrin.
Tegrin. Preventive medicine that helps control dandruff 3 days.
Ready for a restart. In our live coverage of the Talladega 500 on this Sunday afternoon at the end of July, and right now, Bobby Allison is in command. From Colorado Springs, Colorado, a 20-year-old driver, Clark Dwyer, is second. Terry Labonte runs in third. Kaylee Yarborough is fourth. Neil Bonnet is up to fifth. The safety car comes in when they come by. They have completed 60 laps, 159.5 miles down. To the stripe. Green is coming out. 25 cars in the lead lap. Allison breaking away up in front. Labonte second. Kaylee Yarborough right there. He's moving into it. And also up there, just in sixth position, is car number three, Dale Earnhardt.
Which has been so strong. Allison got a good jump on the restart, Kent, but that lead won't last too long. Once they pick his draft up, they'll be right back on him, as we see now, as they head down the backstretch.
Three cautions to date, and Kaylee Yarborough closing rapidly on Bobby Allison, the car number 22, putting a lap on Phil Parsons as they go down into three. And here comes Kale, making short work of closing up on the leader. Kaylee Yarborough surveys the prospects for first spot as they come through turn number four. Ducks back in, 44 Labonte right there, top three. Incredible racing. And these fans agree.
Oh, they really are loving it here today. They've been up and down. They're going to be worn out at the end of the race.
Side by side for the lead. Labonte tucks in. Bonnet lies fourth. The maroon and white car, number 12. The Warner Hodgson car right there in fourth. And there you see. And further back, here comes that 47 down to the bottom. That is Ron Bouchard, the fellow that won in 81. And from inside, Bill Elliott's car, you're watching Bouchard working against the 7 car, which, as you saw, had problems earlier, was in the pits. Kyle Petty still making a go of it. Lead change. They work right. It's not in the lead. That's just back a spot or two. That is the lead. They pulled over the 2 cars.
Yes, Bonnet is beginning to flex his muscles. He's been in it, right in the thick of the battle here, but not really up there for the lead that much. But right now he's there, but here comes Earnhardt. Boy, he has fought for the lead all afternoon.
Allison back there in third. Dale Yarborough falling back. Bouchard pulls up, rather Ricky Rudd pulls up. He's in the fourth. Here's Richard Petty getting back in car number 43. Last time out for that number 43.
Well, they apparently surveyed the situation after making the repairs again, decided it would be worth it to get back out and try to get some of those Winston Cup points.
Earnhardt first, number 22, Allison second, Labonte is third, Dale Yarborough riding fourth, turn three, working the 63rd lap of 188, front four, Elliott's car. Now, as we come into the trioval, Elliott, once again, as we saw in Michigan, could be a real factor before this one is over.
There are so many cars that look so strong in the going up to this point in this race, it would be awfully hard to pick a winner.
Do you pick a line in here, Benny Parsons, or do you just follow and find the hole?
I think that Bill Elliott is probably doing the wisest thing. He's just following along. He's trying to see who's the best. Who can run, who can't run. I think before the day's over, he'll be a serious contender.
Here comes Baker. The number 21 car drops to the inside. There's Allison, your leader. There's Baker in the middle of the track, and Cale gets pressed really high. And remember, that 21 has not been as stable as some other cars out there now.
They have bumped together several times, and they're very close friends. And when they're off the racetrack, before they are showing out there today, they're going at it.
A true test of friendship.
Bouchard
lines up side by side with Earnhardt. Allison stays right there. Folks in Alabama love to see him run and win.
As long as those cars are running side by side back there, it's going to be hard for them to move around Bobby Allison. But now the Cale has moved up on his back bumper. That might push Allison a little further out front. Here comes Petty back into the action.
Richard Petty, number 43, coming back to make a go of it yet today. Points all important. Baker breaks into second place.
And he picked up the draft of Bobby Allison from the inside and scooted right up behind him.
Draft like a wake off a motorboat. He just scooped up the bottom side of the V. You can hear the crowd cheering almost over the sounds of these engines. 600 horsepower at full song. Three wide across the start finish line. Like bullets out of a 30-30 down to the turn number one. Allison deployed first. And Richard Petty comes back up on the banking, like riding in a barrel on these five-story high banks. What is the sensation like, Benny Parsons?
You know, Ken, people have asked that question before, and it's so hard to explain. It's very difficult. I think that there isn't words to explain. You just have to be there.
On the inside, Bouchard moving in. Here's Bouchard, again, three wide in turn number four. Allison stays in front. Richard Petty is down how many laps? About 25?
30 laps now, so no chance of getting even a high position. But still, every position that he might get, somebody else falls out, well, then that will give him a few more points.
Get to the Waldorf Astoria, and it will be a big payoff.
And that kind of traffic we see in New York when they go to Waldorf Astoria for the banquet in December.
199.7 miles per hour in the last lap. What's the sensation like there, Benny Parsons?
That looks like the start of a race at 60 miles an hour, but those cars are running 195 to 200. The sensation is you don't want to be there. Let me out of there because it's too nerve-wracking. Your heart can't stand it. Ron Bouchard has taken the lead again.
Here comes Elliott down on the inside.
Will Bill Elliott this time
pushing for second place. Baker up on the high side as they come by. 67 laps complete this time of 188. 178 miles down.
Oh, boy, Labonte got awfully close to the wall that time. A marvelous piece of driving as he gathered it back in. I think he did touch the wall. It'd be interesting to see if he got any sheet metal up there, perhaps pushing it in against the tire.
Dale Earnhardt currently the leader in the Grand National standings, back there in seventh spot. Here they are, single filing down to the back straightaway. Bouchard Here comes Allison back for the lead. It is Baker into first, Allison into second, and Bouchard falling back in turn three. Swapping back and forth. Now, are they setting each other up here? What are they doing at this time, Benny Parsons?
Well, each of these fellows right now are just simply feeding their egos, because they want to lead the race, and they want to prove to their crew and everyone else that they can lead the race, and they are.
Ron Bouchard was the 13th official race leader in the first 67 laps, Ned.
Unbelievable competition we have going here today. And Benny, I suspect that some of them are trying some of those moves. If it gets down and they're in that same position at the end of the race, just to see what they can do.
Oh, they want to know. Sure, that's exactly right, Ned. Bobby Allison wants to know who he can pass and who he's going to have trouble passing. So that, therefore, he'll make his decision with two or three laps to go.
Well, he took Ron Bouchard right with him and blew right around. Buddy Baker, two cars working together. Bouchard, he wants to lead this thing again. It's the first time that he had led in, I believe, in the first 67 laps, even though he's been right in the thick of the battle.
Kyle Petty made an unscheduled stop and has come back on the track. 69 laps complete this time by. Back with Elliott another time. Cale Yarborough. It's all there with Yarborough's car, and he's back beside Baker another time.
They have a lot
Siamese
of confidence.
Twins, yeah. Another Ford and a Chevrolet.
They have a lot of confidence in each other. You have to have if you're going to run that close together. And Benny Parsons, there are some drivers out there that you don't run that close together.
Well, there's some drivers that you know what's going on when you come off the turn, that they're not going to give you the room that you're required, so you simply have to back off the accelerator. There's others, you know who will give you room and who won't, so therefore, you just drive accordingly.
Nine lead changes in the last 10 laps. Here's Allison, still staying out in front, and the only Chrysler in the field, Buddy Arrington, Scott, Chrysler, Bouchard's number 47, down on the inside, staying right there battling.
Benny, it looks like his car is handling awfully well, even though it's not one of the better cars of the design of the line.
Well, that's the thing that I've been impressed with so far, is that the cars that are not aerodynamically sound, you know, the Buicks and the Fords are probably not as good as a Chevrolet as in aerodynamics, but yet Bouchard, Bobby Allison, and the Fords of Baker and Elliott have led this race, so that tells me that the handling today is very, very important.
Of course, that horsepower is helping right now.
Okay, what helps the most out here? Horsepower, handling, what is it?
I think that horsepower and aerodynamics are the most important thing, but all those without a chassis won't work. So it takes a combination of everything, really and truly.
Sure looks to me like you've got to have the handle today. There's Bodine nipping away, right back up in there behind the seventh place car of car number three, the Earnhardt car, dancing a little here.
Boy, he gets close to that wall as he came over there.
71 laps down. There's Bouchard, the number five, right behind the three. And there's that 47 that slipped back. He went up for the lead and just fell back about five spots.
We saw him a moment ago on the inside coming off turn four, and he lost his momentum. He got on the inside, and he don't have the aerodynamics and maybe not the horsepower. He lost it a little bit, and he was lucky to be able to squeeze into fifth place.
Or the way they gathered him up.
There's a problem on Bouchard's windshield, Ken. We see, of course, they have taped it. During that last caution period, they taped that crack. Hopefully, it won't burst open anymore. But with the pressure that you have at 200 miles an hour, it puts a lot of pressure on that glass, especially after you get a small crack.
Running eighth on the field, Terry Labonte. Running in ninth is Neil Bonnet. And in tenth is Darrell Waltrip. 72 laps down. Get off these leaders when they're running that tight together, Ned.
Just unbelievable racing. We see that Labonte is sticking right up there in that front pack, so apparently that little brush with the wall a few laps back didn't hurt him too much, because he's still able to run fast and not hurting a tire.
Still another lead change. Cale Yarborough goes for it in car number 28, and Baker comes along from the bottom for second spot. Allison relegated to third. Let's go to Chris Economak.
Yeah. 650 horsepower engines are let go. They put black marks on the track. But when Richard Petty decided he had to stop with his car, it tore up some of the asphalt and a lot of his tires. Just an example of some of the forces that are not acting on these cars today. Now down pit road to Mike Joy.
That crack in Ron Bouchard's windshield is something they've dealt with before. Jack Beebe's the car owner. You've had cracked windshields, dropped window nets, all kinds of problems like this at this racetrack.
Yeah, but I think we've got them all solved now. We've got Wayne on here, and he's doing a good job.
He's talking about new crew chief Wayne Bumgardner, and of course they've also won here in 1981. And when that happened, Bouchard credited Baker for teaching him how to draft with the victory. And they're good friends on track and off, and I'm not surprised to see Baker and Bouchard drafting together. We'll see a lot of that this afternoon.
Bouchard's going to, he and Buddy Baker are promoting a short track race up in New England next weekend. Ken and he and Richard Pettier and Buddy Baker are all going to be racing against each other at Thompson Speedway.
Here they are, back in the main straightaway. It is Cale first. Second spot is Baker's car. Then comes Allison, and Bill Elliott lies fourth in the field. So you have those General Motors products intermixed very nicely with the Ford products out there. They're getting equal time as they go down the back straightaway.
Same to me, and they're running fairly equal speed, but Buddy Baker is not content running second.
Oh, indeed. Here's Baker going for it again. Buddy Baker taking a shot at leading this race another time. Now passing Buddy Arrington, the 1975 winner. Baker in front, averaging 200.3 miles per hour.
The Panadol Discovery.
Look.
Panadol.
Remember where we discovered Panadol?
Amsterdam, visiting your aunt.
The windmills.
The canals.
My headache.
Your aunt gave you Panadol.
Said doctors worldwide recommend it.
Two tablets are 1,000 milligrams strong, and they won't upset your stomach.
By the time we had lunch, my headache was gone.
Discover world-proven Panadol. Capsules and now easy-to-swallow coated tablets. As strong a pain reliever as you can buy, and it won't upset your stomach.
Forget everything you know about shaving and get ready for the extraordinary. Get ready for Edge Extra Gel. The extraordinary gel with over 40% more lubricants than the leading foam. For extraordinary closeness. Extraordinary comfort. Experience Edge Extra Gel.
Mr. Wills,
You've
seemed different lately.
Really?
Is that a new suit?
No.
Did you lose weight?
Uh-uh.
New glasses.
No
new glasses.
The best thing about Grecian formula is no one ever knows you're using it. Grecian's not a dye. It's a clear liquid that gradually brings your gray hair back to a natural-looking color.
You shaved your mustache.
I never had a mustache.
I knew that.
Grecian Formula 16, liquid and cream. There's no telling who uses it.
Forget everything you know about shaving and get ready for the extraordinary. Get ready for Edge Extra Gel. The extraordinary gel with over 40% more lubricants than the leading foam. For extraordinary closeness. Extraordinary comfort. Experience Edge Extra Gel.
On network premiere, Brad Davis, Karen Allen, and Jameson Parker are caught up in the politics and passions of the 60s in a small circle of friends.
We're back with you live at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett alongside. I'm Ken Squire. Down to the pits today, Mike Joy and Chris Economaki. We're 78 laps deep, 207 miles into the 188th lap. Talladega 500 for a near $500 million purse. 23 cars running the lead lap, and they're all right here battling for first place. At the moment, the lead has been swapped another time, and now it's Terry Labonte's effort in the Dale Inman car. He's up in front. The second place car remains the Buddy Baker machine. And Benny Parsons, I think you picked the right day to come up and watch the race from up here.
I really did. If I was going to watch a race from in the booth, this was an excellent day to do it, because I tell you, in the race car, you realize those spots are close. It is close competition, but it don't scare you like watching it from up here. I watch it, Ken, and my heart just jumps in my throat because it looks like they're going to crash every corner of every lap.
You're watching
it look that way out there when you're... No, it don't look that bad.
You're watching it live here on CBS, and the amazing thing to me is here you have all these runners competing against each other and yet working in concert in such unison. If one has a problem, it's a problem for all of them, and the fact they can run at 200 miles an hour, as we watch right here, our live pictures from Talladega, Alabama, and run so flawlessly and yet really depend so much on each other. They simply exist, Ned.
They absolutely do depend on each other a great deal. Ken, a little while ago, we said that they were averaging a lead change every two laps. For the last 18 laps, we have had 14 lead changes. Tim Richmond has gone behind the wall. He was one of those that hoped to be up in the front running. Another lead change, and Buddy Baker goes in.
Richmond, the eighth retiree from the event. Now there's Bill Elliott getting inside on our two car cameras side by side out here. There is Jeff Bodine, last lap at 199.8 miles per hour. That's from Bodine's car. And that's from Elliott's car looking the other way. That's seventh and eighth go down to the corner.
Bodine, of course, has two short track victories this year. Brand new team that was put together this year with Harry Hyde, the crew chief, has done an excellent job. Some people said that maybe he was over the hill. He'd been away from the sport too long. Hadn't fielded a tough car in the last several years, but he has proven that he still knows what's going on.
Out in front, Baker. Ford back in front. The 44 car stays right there. The Chevrolet of Terry Labonte. The Billy Hagan, Walter Wood car, prepared by Dale Inman. Back in the tri-oval, 18-degree banking. Allison lies third. Then the yellow car, the orange and white car. That's Cale Yarborough. And comes Bouchard. And notice the blue and yellow, that Wrangler car, which is the number three car of Earnhardt. Now, that car was working better earlier than it seems to be now.
It was, and after this last pit stop, it doesn't seem to be going quite as well. And Benny, it could be that what sometimes we say a bad set of tires, that's not really the case of a bad set of tires.
The sizing is not exactly right because he just is not running as well as he was earlier on.
Excuse me, gentlemen, we have one car way off the pace. It's a major player, Neil Bonnet, exiting turn number two very slowly. Bonnet, something is amiss on car number 12 as he's going into the back straightaway. There you see Bonnet. He's way off the pace, Ned. And what an unfortunate situation for Neil Bonnet, the 1980 winner of this Talladega 500.
And, of course, he's one of only two Alabama drivers in this Talladega 500. Has a lot of fans here looking for him to do well today. He's had a tough year so far. He broke a wrist earlier at Martinsville, Virginia, drove with the injury, and also his crew chief was injured at Daytona, Doug Richard. He's just now getting back. He's still on crutches part-time, but Bonnet now another disappointing day as he heads towards Pitt Road.
82 laps complete, 218 miles are down. Here's Neil Bonnet coming in. His chance of winning this race the second time, coming up short. Field hauling down out of turn number four. Terry Labonte in the number 44, staying very much in the hunt. Dale Inman doing a grand job. They've won a race this year out of Riverside, California, on the road course in a 400-kilometer event. Here's Bobby Allison, right back in the second position, the number 22 car, reviewing further back in the field. Now Bonnet on pit road, moving up. Tommy Ellis, the Virginia driver, is currently in 11th position in the overall standings. Ricky Rudd, the Bud Moore car, is running 12th. Harry Gant, last week's winner, is running 13th. Drake Sachs is in 14th. 15th is Dave Marcus. And the 16th position is Trevor Boyce. As we look further back, the 10th position right now is Lake Speed.
Good run for rookie Greg Sachs. He's one of the modified hot shoes from up in the Northeast. He makes his home out on Long Island, New York. But he almost didn't get started in this race because the car almost didn't fire. There's Sterling Marlin with smoke coming from underneath his car.
We've had eight official retirees, including the Tim Richmond car of recent.
Labonte's on the inside of the racetrack. Something must be amiss on the car number 44 as Allison goes by on the outside. And I don't think he would have made that move just anyway, although he looks like he's still running pretty good, Benny. Now Buddy Baker goes by on the outside, but you don't just make a move like that unless something maybe is wrong.
I would speculate he's on seven cylinders. I just think that something happened to the engine and he backed off.
He's back to Falls, the fifth, the sixth. Baker back in front, the 28 car of Cale Yarborough coming to second, and on the outside, here's the 95 Sterling Marlin car back in the garage area. Across the start-finish line, Baker back for first, really needs a win here today. Here comes Cale Yarborough back on the outside, and Ron Bouchard is coming with him. Allison falls into fifth position. More live coverage of the Talladega 500 on CBS upcoming.
To everyone who loves the thrill of Grand National racing, Budweiser rolls out with Double Thunder. NASCAR legend Junior Johnson leads two of the hottest teams to hit the circuit.
It's Bud for you, for us too. That king of beers is coming true.
The Johnson, Hodgson, Budweiser Chevys are roaring your way with Double Thunder.
For all you do.
This Bud's for you.
Since 1911, there's always been someone trying to outshine Simonize. And trying, and trying. And today, Simonize is as tough to beat as ever. Because today, there's Bodyguard from Simonize. Its silicone formula makes it go on easy, yet it still leaves a brilliant, long-lasting finish. Can anything outshine Bodyguard car wax from Simonize? We don't know, but we suppose someone will always keep trying.
450 degrees. That's how hot parts of your car's engine can get, even in ordinary driving.
Watch how heat and stress can break apart your oil's protective molecules. That's motor oil breakdown. STP Oil Treatment's heat-activated molecules fight motor oil breakdown, fortifying your oil with extra lubricants and anti-wear agents.
Get extra protection. Fight motor oil breakdown with STP Oil Treatment.
STP.
Your car care company.
I'm 32 years old, and I love Kellogg's Frosted Flakes.
Brave adults are coming forward to challenge the notion that Frosted Flakes is just a kid's cereal.
I know there's a tiger in the box. I like the taste. Okay.
Because you loved them as a kid doesn't mean you can't love them as an adult.
One day, our neighbor saw the package on the table.
And we don't even have children.
With that extra crunch in milk, that frosting just right, that taste is great as ever.
Well, they've always been my favorite, so dig in. Frosted Flakes have the taste adults have grown to love. They're great!
Wednesday, Mickey Rooney is a clown in a race against death to make his dream come true.
You're the funniest man I ever met.
To leave him laughing, based on a true story, Wednesday.
At the Alabama International Motor Speedway, you're watching live the battle for supremacy in the 16th annual Talladega 500. Taking a venture at first place, number 47, that is Ron Bouchard on the inside, and he almost swaps some paint, Ned, with Cale Yarborough, who continues to try to hold on to that lead. And here comes car number five. That is Jeff Bodine in the second place here today. And you're with Jeff Bodine in the second position as he follows Cale down into turn number three. Jeff Bodine with his best run. He's come all the way from 28th position. And Bodine is now second. 89 laps complete when they come by this time. Let's get this word from Mike Joy.
You're looking at the broken distributor in Neil Bonnet's car. Neil, this is not the first time for this problem. You guys have had it before.
Well, we've been trying some different ignition systems to see if we can get the problem cured. And, you know, I don't know if that's what it is or not. The car kept getting slower and slower, and then it almost quit, so we got to change it.
There's a wire coil inside the distributor, and if two of those little wires short out, it's easy to have happen. It puts the whole distributor out of commission, so they're replacing it now. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Batteries here. Okay. Who led the race for so many laps is about to stop here. The men servicing his car are the very famous Wood Brothers, who have earned awards for quick pit stops for many, many years. Now, Glenn Wood out with a sign to guide Buddy to a stop here. We should be coming up almost. We have our stopwatch. The plans are to give him fuel, two tires, clean the windshield, and take care of whatever requirement driver Buddy Baker needs. And here he comes, heading down pit road. Our watch is ready, and it's number 21, Thunderbird. In they go, and the men are over the wall, only 5 men allowed over the wall. The watch starts, there's the windshield, and on the outside, taking care of the work. Baker himself wanting more of a cleaning job. He seems to be more primarily concerned. And
caution just coming out.
And there we go. 15, 14, and 10 100 seconds. Back to you, Ken.
Oh, hard hit on car number 03. That is the Birchwill car from out of San Antonio, Texas. This youngster making a super speedway appearance. He's been running on the short tracks. His dad used to build the cars for Clarence Lovell that we saw on the Grand National Tour. And this youngster has just taken a savage head-on crash. Brings out the fourth caution of the day.
Donnie Allison is crew chief on that car, Ken, and thinks very highly of this young fellow.
Car number 03. Caution is out. This is Eddie Birchwell of San Antonio, Texas. Chevrolet, entered by his dad and crew chief by Donnie Allison, has shot into the wall, and you can see it, tremendous damage on the front end of the machine.
They were just about ready for scheduled pit stops. Buddy Baker was in the pits, the first of the front runners to come in for a green flag pit stop. We see Birchwell as he spins around down on the grass. Not much traction once you get on that grass. It looks like the right wheel was almost off the ground. Then it hits the pavement and straightens up. Of course, he had already done the damage on the front end of the car as he got hard into the wall.
There lies car number 03.
I noticed his hand come up.
The driver.
I noticed his hand come up as he was spinning there, so he is okay, I believe.
Well, you can testify to the tremendous, just brute strength of a crash like that. As we saw, you crashed in almost the same place, but the side of the car went in on your car number 55 out here on Friday morning.
On Friday morning, he got the front end, I got the right side of the car, but it literally narrowed my car up about 4 inches, Kenny. It just made it 4 inches narrow, and I just couldn't believe what an impact that car took, and yet everything stayed together.
Under caution. For the fourth time today in the Talladega 500, we'll be back with more live coverage of this Talladega 500 after this word from your local station.
There's more championship action ahead on CBS Sports. Next weekend, coverage of the PGA Tour continues with the final rounds of the Memphis Classic. In the weeks ahead, you'll see golf's top players in the World Series of Golf. 12 auto racing champions will drive identically prepared cars in the final event in the International Race of Champions Series. And see the best in tennis compete in the U.S. Clay Court Championships and in America's premier tennis event, the U.S. Open. When you look for champions, look to CBS Sports.
This is CBS.
Hello, Dick Vermeil for the Super Network, your Cadillac dealers of the Delaware Valley. You know, Cadillac offers many different cars for many different needs. For people who demand responsiveness and handling, check out Cadillac Cimarron or Eldorado, both with front-wheel drive. Compare them with a BMW 318i and 733i. Feature for feature and dollar for dollar, you make the decision yourself. Drive a Cadillac Cimarron or Eldorado at your Cadillac Super Network dealer right now.
Foreign cars. They're not foreign to me. I'm your local man from Meineke. Meineke Discount Mufflers stocks a large inventory of foreign car mufflers. And they're Everlast mufflers. And we have the know-how to install them quickly, because we're trained exhaust system specialists. You drive a foreign car? Come see me, your local man from Meineke, for know-how and quality. And you'll love the price.
Installed from 1893, visit your local independently owned Meineke shop today.
Sunday night sports final with Joe Pellegrino.
Once again, we're with you live here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett, Ken Squire, topside, Chris Economaki, and Mike Joy in the pits to bring you all the action of the 16th running of this near $500,000 race, in which 93 laps have been completed, 247 miles as we get toward the halfway point. Terry Labonte is staying right up in the hunt, looking for his second win of the season. Behind every driver, like Terry Labonte, like Cale Yarborough, Bill Elliott, there are people whose names the average folks just don't know. One of them is the crew chief on this car, a man named Dale Inman, a man all responsible for so much of what makes this man run. When car 44 heads into the hauler, leaving its home in Thomasville, North Carolina, for whatever track, a couple of names immediately come to mind. Team owner, Louisiana millionaire Billy Hagan, and the driver, Terry Labonte. But it's a third party who measures Hagan's dollars and Labonte's destiny. Every hour Terry spends in the driver's seat is equaled by a week's labor for crew chief Dale Inman. He oversees the activities of 15 people, all striving to make Terry a winner. For over two decades, Inman has been preparing racing cars. How does it feel to be behind the scenes rather than behind the wheel?
I just get self-satisfaction for myself, so I don't guess I have to read it in the paper to know that I have contributed. And then what really hurts you is when you make a call that might have cost you the race. That's the ones that really hurt and stick with you, because if you are fortunate enough to win a race, at that point in time in victory circle and everything, you know, you're content and you're happy and everything, but it don't take me long to get to thinking about the next upcoming race, because with the schedule we have to stay right on top of it.
Dale Inman's effort to stay on top of it starts at 6 a.m. each morning in Level Cross, North Carolina, just a half mile up the road from his cousin, Richard Petty. Inman's life is divided between two families. There's his wife, Mary, of 24 years, and their children, daughter Tina and their son Jeffrey. And then there's the other family.
I stay with those boys as much as, or more than I stay with my family, I guess, the ones we travel with.
Team truck driver Bud Crawford and wife Lou, she also drives in the long hauls and is the official scorer, takes Inman's very expensive second family over $1 million
to Michigan or Talladega on any given weekend. A far different journey than what Inman remembers from 25 years ago.
We drove race cars to the track. I went when Lee was driving, and Miss Petty would drive the family car, and he'd have a new engine in, or he'd put a new ring job in the race car, and we'd drive it just to break it in, which was a 100-mile race. In 1958, me and Maurice drove a 57 Oldsmobile to Riverside, California, and raced it without all the interstates and everything.
And then raced it.
And then raced the car, and then drove it home. Finished third.
At any track, preparation is a ritual. It's a ceremony of detail, of patience, of thoroughness, of making everything and everyone in unison for the upcoming race. It is one of the things that Dale Inman does best.
I don't know how he does it. He's about the only guy I've seen that can get 15 people to work together and work together good. It's one of the hardest things there is to do.
Our team is among the top team that puts out effort on everything that they do, and it's a lot of pressure on them too. I mean, it's not only pressure on me, it's pressure on Terry, and it's pressure on them to perform like that. And the result that we're looking for is giving top performance. And if I'm mad sometime, maybe I got to swallow my pride and do something different, and maybe they get mad at me sometime or I get mad at them. But we know at the end of the road what we want to do is make that car perform as good as we can, and that's total team effort. And it's not always easy, but that's the goal that we're searching for.
Here's Dale Inman, the crew chief on Terry Labonte's car. The car's been up front all day. Everybody's aware that your cousin has won 200 Grand National races, but not that many people know you've won 183. That's quite an accomplishment in itself.
Well, I've been around for a long time and a lot of wins, I've seen a lot of stock car races, and, we're just looking for another one here today. That's what I'd like to have. The car vibrates once in a while. I don't know what it is. I hope it was that last set of tires, but Terry will run good, and then he'll pull over, and he says he just feel like it's going to blow up. I hope it was that set of tires, but I really don't know. A lot of good cars out there right now.
Well, aside from the vibration, what does Terry say the track is like? What kind of shape is it in?
Well, we've had to put a little bit of wedge in the car, but other than that, when he leads, like when he would lead and change leads with Buddy, he would run probably 2 or 3 mile an hour quicker when he was in front. So evidently the track must be in pretty good shape, and the car seems to be working pretty good. But there's about 12, 15 cars can hang on nose to tail.
Is he more comfortable in front of the field or running in behind somebody?
Well, I don't know. I hadn't talked to him about that, but two or three times down through here, he's went for the lead, and he's been cut off. And, of course, we dropped down one time when we was leading and because he felt a vibration. And we hadn't talked like that. We're just kind of playing it as it comes and goes, and it's according to who you're racing with, too,
Well, Richard Petty, Dale's cousin, has the 200 wins, but this fella has 183, and the people all up and down this pit road know and respect that a lot of the strategy comes from right here, and that's what they're trying to figure right now for this race, Ken.
One of the nice people with a real nice family, Dale Inman down in Level Cross. All right, we're getting down to 96 laps complete of the 188. A rookie has crashed here hard, Eddie Bierschwell of San Antonio, Texas. Earlier we asked Darrell Waltrip, why do rookies have so many incidents at this track?
It's a track you can run around here at 195 to 200 miles an hour and feel pretty comfortable, feel like it. You got everything under control. Therein lies the problem. It kind of lulls some of the drivers to sleep, particularly the younger ones that say, hey, I'm a race car driver, look at me, I'm going 200. And those are the guys that this racetrack reaches out and bites real quickly.
At the Alabama International Motor Speedway, 96 laps are complete. We are waiting for a report on Eddie Bierschwell right now. Be back with you shortly with more live coverage today.
If you're serious about business, you're already investing a lot of time and money and effort in your career. Now think for a second. Isn't your career, your future, worth 42 cents a day more?
Save $7.50 off the cover price with a subscription to the Wall Street Journal. Order 19 weeks for $39. Phone toll-free 800-228-2210. That's 19 weeks, just $39. And save $7.50. Phone 800-228-2210.
This is Mr. Goodwrench. Did you know the spark plugs in your GM car or truck make 8,000 explosions a minute? And each explosion depends on an exact amount of gasoline and air to make your car or truck perform right. So to make sure all those explosions happen precisely, get a professional tune-up by Mr. Goodwrench. We have quality GM parts, equipment, and training available.
It's another of Mr. Goodwrench's good ways.
You keep that great GM feeling with you and GM parts.
Confident, sure, secure. Sure salutes America's Olympic athletes.
Raise your hand.
You got it.
Raise your hand.
You know it. You feel confident, secure. We salute America's Olympic athletes, past, present, and future. Let's raise our hands to them all.
Raise your hand. Raise your hand.
Sure Antiperspirant, helping you stay dry and confident, is a proud sponsor of the United States Olympic team.
Fresh ground cinnamon. It makes a delicious difference in my cinnamon rolls. I'm Mrs. Olson. You know, the right ingredients are so important in good cooking. That's why Folgers is good cooking. It has that just right delicious ingredient, mountain-grown coffee. The richest kind. Delicious. Now that's mountain-grown coffee. Folgers is good cooking.
One man and one woman will emerge as masters of the clay at the U.S. Clay Court Championships, the women's and men's singles finals in 2 weeks on CBS Sports.
In the Talladega 500, Jeff Bodine has just appropriated first place. Kaylee Yarborough is running second. Darrell Waltrip is in third. Running fourth is Bill Elliott. Fifth is Ron Bouchard. Sixth is Harry Gamp. In the seventh place is Trevor Boyce. And going eighth right now is Lake Speed. Here is a report on pit road from Mike Joy.
Well, Canada, every other major speedway in the country, including Daytona, the start-finish line is located right across where I'm sitting, right at the midpoint of pit road in the tri-oval area, mid-distance between the two turns. And last year, I stood here with Bud Moore as the cars came by, and his driver at the time, Dale Earnhardt, you could see him come by here, but you didn't know he'd won the race. Now, is that frustrating to stand here and not know what's happened, or does it just add to the suspense when you know the finish line is further down the racetrack?
Well, you know, when you come by, like I say, last year here, when they come by to get the checker flag, we didn't know who won till they told us on the radio and exactly who won. So it is frustrating when we can't see the start-finish line, see who you won or where you didn't.
The reason they did that, Ken, the best seats are the ones right in front of pit road and the tri-oval. So when they built this track in 1969, to make those seats down near turn one more saleable, that's where they put the finish line. And it's made for some of the best racing in NASCAR history.
Well, that is an old promoter. That certainly makes sense, doesn't it?
It certainly does.
Well, now we're over half the distance in the race. We've completed 97 laps, 255 miles are down. How's the field doing?
We have 21, amazingly, cars still in the lead lap. And we are past the halfway point. You know, there have been 10 different winners on the series, the circuit, so far this year, pointing up the type of competition that we have. I believe it's 11 different winners instead of 10, and still have 21 in the lead lap. Any one of those 21 are still capable of winning this race.
Let's take a look at how they stack up. Back in the ninth position, we just reviewed the first eight for you. And car number 44 is in ninth, Labonte. Then in 10th is Rusty Wallace. Running 11th is car number 75, and the driver of that car is Dave Marcus. Going in the 12th position now is Ricky Rudd, and 14th is Buddy Baker. 13th is Buddy Baker. 14th is Tommy Ellis. The 15th position is now holding car number 15, the red car, and the Earnhardt car is in the 12th position. The 16th position is car number 52, with a change of drivers. Morgan Shepherd is there now for the injured Jimmy Means, injured down at Charlotte. Going 17th is Greg Sachs. And the 18th position and in the lead lap is that youngster. That is Bobby Hillen. And 19th, a lap down, is Bobby Allison's car number 22. In 20th, being two laps down, is car number 71, they're reporting. They're showing Allison a lap down in this report we just had from scoring.
I believe that's incorrect right now. He had made a pit stop just a moment ago. In fact, he was lead. He stayed out on the track during this caution longer than most any others. Then he came in for a pit stop. So he should be still in the lead lap, but at the tail of the lead lap. So it's 19 instead of the 21.
And you're right. And they're just changing that and showing Allison now as the last car in that lead lap. And then back in 20th would be the Mike Alexander car. Let's see if we can get a word from Jeff Bodine, now leading in the event. He has come from 28th position to be out in front. question is, Jeff, do you think you can hang around and be there at the end of 188 laps? Jeff Bodine?
Yeah, I hear you.
You think you can still be there, first place, when we get down to lap 188?
Well, our car isn't strong enough to run out front, but we can run with the lead cars in a draft. I'm sure I'd have restart, Cale, and a few guys will go by me, but we're going to try to hook on and just stay up front.
Car seems to be running very well. It did not qualify that well, Jeff, but right now, the way you've been moving up through the traffic, it looks like it's handling just about as good as you could want.
It is handled awful good. It's really beautiful. Harry Hyde's got this car to drive any place on a racetrack, and that's enabled me to go high or low and get up front. And, you know, we're just going to try to hang in there, and hopefully we'll be around at the end of this race.
Jeff, most of your past experience, winning experience, was on short tracks. How do you like running these 200-mile-an-hour laps?
I love it, the ball out here, especially when your car's handling good. It's really a lot of fun, but you've always got to remember just how fast you're going and try to keep your head about it. Don't get in trouble.
Jeff Bodine in car number 5, the leader, and you'll be with him when we come down for the restart shortly here this afternoon as okay. We are finishing in the 4th caution period of the day. Here's Mike Joy.
I'm with Waddell Wilson, the man that put Cale Yarborough's car on the pole with that 202-mile-an-hour lap. Going around here over 200 miles an hour for one lap is something, but getting that car to work all day long, that's another story, isn't it?
Well, that's right. You know, qualifying the race by itself, and then this is altogether different, and you have to change your chassis entirely, and we did some adjustments after the last practice yesterday, and I've asked him during the caution sessions, and Cale says the car is fine, so we haven't made any adjustments since the start of the race.
Well, isn't that kind of rare? I've seen your team, a race you won on CBS in Michigan, where you carried our camera, and you were in there cranking on those wedge bolts every pit stop. That's got to be a little different for you.
Well, if the driver's complaining, you got to do everything you can to help him. So as long as he don't complain, that suits me fine. And I feel like we're in good shape.
Back upstairs.
Restart. Bodine up in front. Interesting situation here. Allison pitted for just a few drops of fuel. That's going to put him out of sync for the rest of the field, and it couldn't, Ed. Make a difference at the end.
Could very well. We saw Buddy Baker in the pits just as the caution came out. He did not lose a lap, but maybe if they can go a few extra laps and catch a caution, that could make the difference.
Bodine running first. There you see the Petty car. Remember, it is several laps down. Cale Yarborough back for the lead on the inside, the number 28 car, pulling alongside, and they go wheel to wheel for turn number 3 and go up on the side of the barrel.
Yarborough wasted no time in putting that Chevrolet back out front. He's been up near the front, in front, or near the front all day, and now we're seeing Waltrip get into the picture. He really hasn't been up there that much today.
Waited for halfway, and now Waltrip begins to show his strength, as he did yesterday in the IROC race, where he laid fourth or fifth most of the afternoon, and then came alive in the last two or three laps, and particularly in the final lap. Waltrip now in second, trying to win it 3 times. No one else has won it more than once, with the exception of Darrell Waltrip. Waltrip, the only 2-time winner of this race.
He's a master at the drafting, and you see him move right up on Cale Yarborough's bumper. Now, it'll be interesting to see if he wants to take the lead. I don't think he led a lap yet today and would not have received the 5 bonus points that goes along with it. And, of course, he's right in the thick of the battle for the championship.
Third place, Bodine. Fourth place, Bouchard. He has stayed up in there. Labonte in the shuffle. By the throng.
We saw Neil Bonnet's car being worked on earlier. He's back out in the running, but he lost 10 laps while in the pit, so he's out of the running as far as the win's concerned, but has a good chance of picking up some money and some points.
There's Neil Bonnet.
There's Tommy Ellis, the guy we talked about at the top of the show, moving right around Richard Petty, and he's following Dale Earnhardt. So Ellis is still in this thing, the rookie from Richmond, Virginia.
And he is having just a wonderful run today. Another lead change coming up. Here's Yarborough and Waltrip at it side by side. Tommy Ellis said he never knew the fellow who hired him to drive that car. He called him up on the phone one Sunday night, and it took him till Wednesday to agree to drive. Boy, it certainly changed the image of Tommy Ellis, and he's doing a marvelous job in Grand National.
There's one guy that really has taken his hard knocks in racing, Ken, and he deserved a ride in Grand National, and a good one. He is a good race driver.
Well, anybody that can knock around with Ray Hendrick for the many years that he did down there on those Virginia circuits, you know he's got to be tough to exist. And he was he won 19 races in a row one year, 28 or 29 in all.
Very tough competitor. They're getting that speed back up there over 200 miles an hour on that last lap. Bodine is able to hang right in there. Of course, he said that he'd be able to do that. He figured that Yarborough would move around him. You heard him say that, and sure enough, it happened. But he's able to pick up the draft and stay right there with him. There's that Bill Elliott car back there in fourth place. He's been right there all afternoon.
Can't get a picnic plate in between any of those cars. Right in the front six positions. And Baker goes down to the inside, and he's trying to loop back up around and get himself back in this race. Taking the bottom side and picking up a spot. He's up behind Bouchard now.
Another driver that normally runs real strong here, the fifth place car in line there, is Late Speed, car number one. He had some good runs here at Talladega.
And he's had some good runs on a lot of tracks, and he is bound to pull one off soon. Now we're looking back at the Bill Elliott car that rested on the outside of the front row for this event. He'll be around at the finish. They build good, strong engines. Be very surprised if we don't see him part of this act down at the end. How about it, Benny Parsons?
As a matter of fact, Bill Elliott Wednesday blew an engine, Ken. And we are 17, 18 races into the season. That's the first engine he's lost this year. Just an unbelievable record for any team.
Tribute to his brother Ernie and the fellas who put those things together.
Exactly. It sure is. Ernie Elliott and Dan, his brothers, does a super job.
They come down to the main straightaway. Elliott trying to break through. Ron Bouchard's wife, she's scoring for them this afternoon.
She's always in the pit. They had a little race, that's Paula Bouchard, a little race last week for the ladies in a different kind of cars up in Pocono, Pennsylvania, and she won that thing. Of course, her dad was a famous race driver, too, Ed Clifton from up in the Northeast, who had many, many wins in modified competition.
Got trouble in turn number four. There's a smoker up in turn number four. It's 52. That would be the Morgan Shepherd car easing back onto pit road.
Well, a tough break here. Jimmy Means owns that car. Of course, Jimmy normally drives it, but as you mentioned earlier, he was injured at Charlotte in a wreck, and he's had several different drivers in the car, but it looks like the engine has let go on that car here, and the caution is out once again. Morgan Shepherd, a tough-luck driver, another of the guys who's taken the hard knocks in the sport, former national champion in the sportsman division, but he's just having tough luck here today.
Fifth caution of the day. Caution number five as the engine erupts on Morgan Shepherd's car number 52. Cale Yarborough deployed in first. Can he stay there to win the Talladega 500 for the first time in his career? He's won 81 races, won the national title three times. You've seen him in those brilliant victories at Daytona, but this race has always evaded his efforts. Now, 106 laps have been completed this afternoon in our live coverage of the Talladega 500, and we'll have more in a moment.
From Pontiac comes the one-of-a-kind 84 Firebird Trans Am. You can order it with aerodynamic ground effects, a high-output 5-liter V8, high-tech turbo wheels, and a close-ratio 5-speed. Knowing you, you probably will. Trans Am, only from Pontiac.
We build excitement, Pontiac.
When athlete's foot makes you itch, 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 and you itch, and you itch, and you twitch, 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 ditch the itch, 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 ditch the itch, itch, itch with Absorbeen Junior.
Absorbeen Junior stops itch in seconds, kills fungus on contact, helps heal athlete's foot. So when you have athlete's foot,
ditch the itch, 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 ditch the itch, itch, itch with Absorbeen Junior.
Ditch the itch with Absorbeen Junior in liquid or powder.
Staying in shape gives my business career an extra edge. Speed Stick deodorant gives you an edge too. Speed Stick's the wide stick. Gives you man-size odor protection all day. The wide stick feels good going on, and it takes just a few strokes. It's a great value, too. In this world, a little extra edge is all you need.
Let the wide stick give you the edge. Speed Stick deodorant.
By Menon.
Ask Al Holbert, 1983 Camel GT champion, what it takes to win. And here's what he says.
It takes a lot of things. Skill. Nerve. Pressure.
preparation and the best performance products I can get my hands on.
That's why Al Holbert demands high-performance CRC chemicals.
CRC, the professional's choice. I wouldn't settle for less.
The complete line of performance chemicals from CRC. For cars like yours.
Next, the PGA pros will shoot for the title when play continues at the 33rd Hartford Open. Live coverage on CBS Sports.
Back with you live once again at the Alabama International Motor Speedway for the Talladega 500. Stay tuned to CBS Sports for final round coverage of the Greater Hartford Open today. That's the picture. After three rounds completed with Peter Jacobson first, Marco Mira in second place.
He's a big car buff also, Ken, so we here at Talladega have got to be pulling for Marco Mira, but he's got a good ways to go.
That's coming up next today here on CBS. Here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway, 108 laps are now in the book of 188 to be run. 287 miles have thus far been erased from this race. And we're watching car number nine, Bill Elliott, take the lead. Here is Mike Joy standing by with Ernie Elliott.
Ken, when the caution flag comes out, the pit crews can go about their job a little more leisurely, take the time to change four tires, and almost everybody did that. Not the Elliotts. Ernie, why not?
Well, we just put four new tires on just a few laps back, and, you know, there was really no need to change tires now. The car's handling good, and the tire wear is real good. And, you know, we felt like that, you know, just to get the car and get in and out and get back up toward the front of the pack, you know, was more of a benefit right now than it was to change tires. So, you know, we just didn't see his changing tires as necessary.
What was the reaction back in Talladega and Dawsonville when you folks won on Father's Day here on CBS?
Well, it was pretty good, you know. We sure enjoyed the win, I can tell you that.
Best of luck to you today.
Thank you very much.
Are you superstitious, Ned?
Not really.
Well, how about this? You know, there have been 15 previous races, and the man on the outside, that's been the hottest position here. Five times the man from the outside of the front row has won it. Bobby Allison won it from there in 71, and Buddy Baker and Donnie Allison. A little assistance the year that he won it from Darrell Waltrip, Neil Bonnet, and Darrell Waltrip himself in 1982. No other position except fourth. They've got a couple of winners from there. But five times the winner has come from second place.
Well, if that's the indication, Bill Elliott's got to be feeling pretty good right now about his chances. Of course, he's sitting up front at the moment. As we get the one lap signal, we'll be going back to green as they come around the next time. And the fans might wonder, they saw the engine go up in smoke on Morgan Shepherd's car. He didn't wreck. No other cars wrecked. They wonder, well, why did they need to bring the caution out? Lots of times, in this case in particular, oil, water, other debris comes from underneath the car when the engine lets go, and so they need to clean the track up because it is a hazard to the other drivers.
Ready for a restart. Bill Elliott in front, Baker second, Gant third. Jeff Bodine, line fourth. A monumental month this month of July in motorsport. It began with that great race at the Meadowlands with the Indianapolis cars successfully bringing big league racing back to the New York area. And then, of course, on the 4th of July at Daytona Beach, Richard Petty won his 200th race. And no less a personage than the President of the United States there to honor Petty as well as the entire sport. And Formula One had a tremendous success in Dallas. And here today, near 100,000 people enjoying this great racing classic. It's been a great month, I think, when they look back over the years, 1984. This month of July, Ned, will be one of the more important.
Oh, there's no doubt about it, Ken. It's just been a historic month in the sport of auto racing.
Did you have fun interviewing the president?
Oh, it was just a treat that I could never expect in life, and one that certainly that I'll never forget.
All right, we're getting set for a restart. We've had five caution periods. Attrition continues to build. 11 cars are now out, with the latest retiree being the Morgan Shepherd car. Field is coming down. The slow cars are on the inside. Fast cars are on the outside for the restart. They'll come down to complete lap 110, 292 miles, and we begin to get within sight of the finish of this race. 188 laps to the mark for this 2.6 mile track. Still, we have some 19 cars running in the lead lap. Thunder moves into turn number one as Elliott gets a little bit of a breather there, about four car lengths. That'll go away in a hurry.
That's Bill Parsons down on the inside. This is the first time on a restart, Ken, I think that we've had a Ford up front. Apparently, it didn't accelerate quite as well as down to General Motors cars because Phil Parsons was able to move away. Even though Phil had several laps down, he had a drive shaft problem earlier.
Neil Bonnet taking the lap back, and here comes Baker meaning business. Baker going into first place as he squeezes through off the left automobile.
Give him a little bit of a hole, and he'll move right in it.
Buddy Baker now first. And look at that jam session coming out of turn number four. Down the line, Baker first, Elliott second, and Ford's lineup one and two. And all of a sudden, here comes Harry Gamp. The Hal Needham Burt Reynolds car is up into third. Harry Gamp, who won last week in a tremendous battle with Cale Yarborough in Pocono, Pennsylvania, in that 500-mile race. Here comes Gant back into it. He has not been a factor until now. Let's see if he'll stay there.
He hasn't been a factor, but he has run well all day long, certainly staying in the lead lap. But now, maybe he has just been holding back a little bit. Here's Bobby Allison trying to come back on the inside once again. But two of the cars that Gant battled with down to the wire, Bill Iller was one of them last week in Pocono. And, of course, as you mentioned, Cale Yarborough, and they're certainly still in the thick of it. If he wins today, he'll have to battle those two plus about half a dozen others.
The leaders swarm through the tri-oval down to the start-finish line another time. The Talladega Express with Bo Dine there in fourth. There's Bill Elliott in second, looking over the shoulder of Buddy Baker, the man in first, at 200 miles an hour. I like the sign on the back of that. Have you driven one of those cars lately? Not at that speed.
And we wouldn't advise it either.
No, sir, but the blue lights couldn't catch you. Here's Bill Elliott pulling in. Moving up. Now one car length back. Back in 11th is Bouchard. 12th is Waltrip on the restart, and Cale then was 13th, and 14th was Bobby Hillen, who's having a very good run today. Kid from Midland, Texas.
A youngster who has Jake Elder as the crew chief on the car, certainly one of the top crew chiefs in the business, and boy, they bunch up again for the lead.
Scrambling down through 3 and 4. Or rather through 1 and 2.
The first time that Gant has put his car up front, so maybe he's holding back a little bit.
Maybe he has been holding back a little bit, Ned, because it is the first time he's been in the lead all day. The team looked pretty strong going for the lead just then.
Travis Carter car looking very strong now.
A lot of times after pit stops, Gant, they do make adjustments on the chassis of the cars, and that will help them to look much stronger as they come back out.
Last lap, 199.08 miles per hour. Look at them ricochet in that draft. 44 Labonte right there in that Dale Inman car.
Bill Elliott saw that hole down there, but he wasn't about to make the move to go down there. Here comes Dale Earnhardt getting back into the picture. Haven't seen much of him here recently, but he'll be there.
Flat foot all the way around. Car number 9 just not lifting as you hear that motor work. Gant in front. You think he has the horsepower to stay there in the last lap like Cale Yarborough does, Benny Parsons?
I don't think there's probably anybody there that has the horsepower that Cale Yarborough does. But I don't know that horsepower is going to be all it's going to take. It's going to take a lot of strategy and being at the right place. Cale Yarborough seems to have the knack of being at the right place as well as horsepower.
There you are with Jeff Bodine. There's late speed in the number one car just inside of him. Just making those easy little moves at 200 miles an hour. You don't want to make any big moves here.
We've talked about the competition, the lead changes we've had here. Now, Buddy Baker has led more laps than anybody else. He's been in the lead 13 different times for 22 laps. That's not much.
Tommy Ellis has come back up to fourth position. Sonny Hutchins, Ray Hendricks, are you listening? Allison down into turn number 3. Enthusiasm there. Do you think it's for Allison?
There's a hole. Is he going to go there? Yes, he is. Moving right up on the outside, moving around. Tommy Ellis trying to pick up the draft off Blake Speed at the car number 1, and he does it very nicely.
Blake Speed back again. He has to win a race pretty soon. Does a little dance up there. Turn 2. Working the 117th of 188 laps. Gant back in fourth position. fake enthusiast there.
Hey!
They really get into it. And Earnhardt, we saw him earlier in this race. He was dominant, perhaps more so than any other driver, even though Buddy Baker played more laps than anybody. But Earnhardt was right there in the early part of the going. But for the last 75 miles, haven't seen that much of him. But here he is again.
Former Grand National Champion, former Rookie of the Year. Working his way back into the lead, looking for win number 10 to become the first man in history to win this race back-to-back. Live flag-to-flag coverage today on CBS. And we still have some 18 cars all in the struggle in the front-running position. Earnhardt Chevrolet is right there, the Richard Childress prepared car. Down into turn number 3, and here comes Baker right with him. And he's beginning to show some legs on that car, Benny Parsons.
He really is. Terry Labonte is in third place right now. He ain't passed Terry again. And Bobby Allison going down the back straightaway. So it looks like Labonte is going to be put on a pretty serious challenge for the lead.
Back they come to the trioval. Across the line, down to the turn number 1. There you see Allison on the inside. And on the outside is Lake Speed. As you stay with Bill Elliott's car. Here's a report from Chris Economat.
Well, with some 70 laps of racing remaining, Buddy Baker and a Ford will have to make 2 pit stops for fuel. But Bobby Allison and a lot of the other Chevy engine drivers will only have to make 1 pit stop. So what the people in the Ford pits are hoping for is a yellow flag so they can get 1 free one. Back to you, Ken.
5 cautions to date in the 16th running of the near $500,000 Talladega 500. Baker first, Earnhardt second. Coming to third moves Terry Labonte with Harry Gannon fourth. And now there's a switch up front. Baker taking a shot at it. And we see Labonte down to the inside of the blue and white number 44 making his move. Gaggle of cars ripping through there. You see the number 5 of Bodine hanging on to Cale Yarborough. And Trevor Boyce in the 48. And that's the James Hilton prepared car. Remember, James Hilton won a race here in this Talladega 500. There's Trevor Boyce out of Calgary, Alberta, Canada, and right by him, 1972, Hilton won this race. Trevor Boyce would sure like to pull it off, and he stayed right up there in the lead lap this afternoon.
He's done a very good job. He's a very determined young man, Ken, and he doesn't mind getting up there mixing up with him either.
Earnhardt, Labonte to the outside. Now, Labonte was in that photo finish back in 1981 that Bouchard won. Remember, he was on the high side, Waltrip in the middle. And Bouchard snuckered him right down on the inside.
Labonte was in the thick of another four-car battle here, and another one of those close finishes at Talladega.
How's the Earnhardt car running? Here's the story from Mike Joy.
Well, Ken, Chris reported that some of the Chevrolet engine cars can go the distance on one more pit stop. But Richard Childress, your car, it's going to be close on gas.
Yeah, with us out front right now, it is. We may stay out there a few laps and then try to see. It looks like we're going to need some gas. We may fall back a little bit and hold it. It's going to be real close.
You may be able to make it on one pit stop, but not if he stays out front.
No, not right now. We're just going to watch and see what happens, and we'll tell him what it looks like about 20 laps into this run.
And when he says staying out front, he's burning more fuel than those fellas running behind him, because we saw earlier Bill Elliott was able to decelerate. We talked about it a little bit. When you're running in the thick of the cars, you can't accelerate fully all the time, and Benny Parsons, that does conserve fuel.
It does conserve fuel, because when that throttle is wide open, it's taking the maximum amount of fuel. When you back off the throttle, it doesn't take in quite as much.
Last lap, 198.2 miles per hour.
Dale Earnhardt's getting his wish, because Terry Labonte has taken the lead. He's going to be able to draft now.
And here comes Harry Gantt. Gantt on the inside. Assistant driver. Now you're beginning to see a three-car rush, and Baker went right down in the apron to annex second place again. Buddy Baker, the number 21, scooted right down to the bottom of the track. And that is not recommended.
Certainly the car is working, or he wouldn't be able to make that kind of a move.
Here comes Waltrip around number 9, Elliott. This is going to look like the International Race of Champions, the way it's building right now at the finish net.
Unbelievable. Still about 19 cars running in the lead lap. There's some good cars out there that are still running that have had their problems. As we mentioned, Neil Bonney, that's 10 laps down. Phil Parker. Carson's lost 23 laps. Richard Petty lost 32 laps. Kyle Petty is 11 laps down there after having some overheating problems. Buddy Arrington is still running strong, but he's three laps off the pace. And Steve Moore, who started in the shotgun position here, is currently running in five laps down.
As you look at the leaders, let's review back a little further in the field. The sixth place is Allison. The seventh place is Bouchard. The eighth place is Cale. And they're swapping back and forth in there. Ninth, Ellis. The 10th spot had been, the 10th spot is now that 48 car. He was back to 14th, and back comes Trevor Boyce again, and Elliott has been pushed back to 11. And also up in that group is the car number 51, the Greg Sachs car, in 12th.
And then Jeff Bodine would be right behind him. Phil Parsons is in there, but he's, as we mentioned, is several laps down.
Average speed is 147.7. There's Wesley Wallace in the number 88 car,
who had a super run last week at Pocono, Pennsylvania. He finished in sixth position in the lead lap. Just was the top finishing rookie and qualified well here. Started in the 10th position and has run well all day.
Back up in front, still another lead change. Labonte for first. Baker trying the inside, nosing up in there and then coming back. As they swap back and forth by just a few feet now and then. Those aren't official lead changes. Labonte has it for the moment. Baker for second.
What he would like to do right now, he sees about a little bit of daylight back to Dale Earnhardt's car. He was right up on Labonte's bumper there. He'd like to see if they could hook up and pull away from the rest of the field, but I don't think that's going to happen at this point.
Gary Yarbrough that time, Kim, up in the third and fourth corner was extremely high, up in the gray area, the place that many cars run. I think it's because when he gets cars in front of him, behind him, he moves around a little bit. His car is not handling as well, and therefore, there is traction in that gray area because no one's been there. There's a tremendous amount of traction.
Elliott scooting down below. Car number 33 Gannon closing on Lake Speed. Elliott beginning to wind them in another time and not gaining ground on that inside. That's not the way to go through. In fact, he loses ground again.
He certainly does. He pushed him back two positions instead of gaining one. Now he's got to try it again. Doesn't give up. Moves right around Walker now, pulling up on Harry Gant down on the inside. He had the momentum as he went into turn three, but let's see if he's able to hang up there with it. He's been staying even with Gant right now. In fact, gaining a little bit on him as they come off the fourth turn. Now Gant begins to pull away a little bit.
Are just remarkable. Watching Harry Gant tending right to his knitting in that car number 33 as alongside came Bill Elliott. Up in front, two cars are trying to draw away. Last lap, how about this one? 199.9.
As strong as they were running at the start of the race.
199 mile an hour average. And last lap for number 44, Terry Labonte, and dragging right along with him, number 21. Buddy Baker. Then comes Earnhardt, number three.
I would say that Baker is definitely trying to conserve fuel right now because he had made a pit stop earlier than anyone else had during the green flag stop, and he knows that he's not getting that good of gas mileage today. Normally, on this kind of a racetrack, they can go about 100 miles on a tank of fuel, but when you're running at that kind of a speed, it makes it awfully hard to get that kind of mileage.
Cale Yarbrough going to fourth. Here's Richard Petty with a familiar towel in his mouth. A little moisture there. Car that will go to the Smithsonian following today's race. The car that won the Firecracker 400 the 4th of July at the Daytona International Speedway and recorded the 200th career win for this man, Richard Petty, in car number 43. Taking the last ride with old 43.
Now the fans might wonder, well, why would he race that car in other races? The car was built especially for Daytona and Talladega, the super high speed racetrack. There are little characteristics about this car that simply wouldn't work when you get to some of the shorter tracks like I'll be running for the rest of the year.
A little bit like riding the Spirit of St. Louis, not quite, but a little. The flavor of history going with you there as you ride with Richard Petty. Of course, getting an opportunity to be in the chair beside the king, that's a thrill unto itself, whether he's running first or 31st. Baker going for the lead, and there goes Ellis again. He's working with Trevor Boyce, and there's Phil Parsons.
Stewart brother's doing pretty well out there today, Benny.
He's keeping up there, and he's learning a great deal. As Ned mentioned a moment ago, he did have a dry shaft problem. He's a lot of laps down, but he's getting invaluable experience.
This is the track where Phil Parsons crashed going down on the turn one of the race they have here in May and rolled over about nine times, and one car went absolutely underneath him. And he's right back out and doesn't seem to bother him a tad.
Doesn't seem to bother him a bit. It bothered me that day, I'll tell you that.
Tommy Ellis, number four, 36 years old, stays right there, right up in the hunt. Ninth position unofficially right now. Long back straightaway and into number three. This looks like you can go forever going down that back straightaway.
It really looks like, as you come off the second corner and go down, it seems like you go almost forever because it is such a long way down to turn three.
It doesn't really take you long, though.
But it really don't take you long to get there.
7 or 8 seconds. Terry Labonte's crew checking, concerned about the fuel. Kale Yarborough has the lead. Kale back in front, still knocking on the door that is never open. And giving him victory lane here in the Talladega 500. More live in a moment.
Time. It takes time to create quality. The quality taste of Budweiser. Time to select the choicest ingredients. For exclusive Beechwood aging. To brew the distinctively clean, crisp taste of Budweiser. Quality taste. That's what people want in a cold glass of beer. And this is the one they want. Somebody still cares about quality.
Most guys spend Sunday taking it easy. Not me. When I'm racing a Bandit, there's no taking it easy. So I'm out here early before a race trying to relax. Just me and my scope. Just a pinch gives me real tobacco pleasure without lighting up. And that wintergreen flavor's a real winner.
Go smokeless with Skoll or Copenhagen. A pinch is all it takes.
This is Mr. Goodwrench. Did you know that your GM car's engine uses more air than gasoline? For every sip of gas, it takes 15 gulps of air. That's why a clean air filter helps keep you from wasting power or damaging your engine. So let Mr. Goodwrench check your oil, fuel, and air filters. Chances are you'll save gas and money, too.
It's another of Mr. Goodwrench's good ways
to keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM parts.
Who's been using my razor?
Mine burns me.
But don't blame your razor. Use my ice blue Aqua Velva.
It turns red hot razor burn to cool comfort. Smooths, too.
My Aqua Velva Man.
There's something about an ice blue Aqua Velva Man.
Mommy beats Daddy.
I quit.
Yvonne, how do you do it?
Isn't easy.
Now, after Morgan was born, my doctor told me I had iron poor blood. Now I protect myself, eat right, and take Geritol. It's great protection against iron poor blood.
12 auto racing champions will test their driving skill in identically prepared cars in the final event in the International Race of Champions Series in 2 weeks on CBS Sports.
Less than 150 miles to the finish of the 16th annual Talladega 500 live today on CBS as you watch Kale Yarborough trying to win it for the first time. Terry Labonte also trying to pull it off for his first career win in this great race in the second position. Then the man that won it last year lies third, Dale Earnhardt. Going fourth is Ron Bouchard, the 81 winner. And next in line comes Bobby Allison. Allison running in fifth, going sixth currently is Harry Gant. Seventh is Lake Speed. The eighth position falls to Buddy Baker. Ninth is Waltrip. Tenth, Tommy Ellis. Going 11th, Bill Elliott. 12th is the Jeff Bodine car. 13th is Trevor Boyce. Running 14th is Frank Sachs. One more fuel stop for sure for all of them. Average speed 147 miles an hour. No records today as we've been interrupted five times in the course of the race. Let's go to Mike Joy with Dale Inman.
Well, Kev, they're hoping it will only be one more fuel stop. And the Terry Labonte pit, a big strategy conversation looking at the lap charts. If they can stay behind Kale Yarborough, they'll conserve enough fuel that they know they can go this race and finish on just one fuel stop. But if Labonte goes out and runs in the lead, they'll have to stop twice. So he is laying back a bit, and that may be true of some other drivers a little further back in the field.
The report on the driver of car number 03, Eddie Barswell of San Antonio, Texas, is that he's okay, Ned.
Well, that's good.
They took him over to the hospital.
He took a very hard lick against the wall, but as we pointed out before, these cars are constructed so well, they build in every possible safety feature into them, and when they hit the wall that hard, it's always good to hear that the driver is okay.
There's that long back straightaway. Good place to pass going into three. Benny Parsons has at Daytona right here.
This is absolutely the best place on the racetrack to pass. And when it comes down to the last lap, I would expect that any driver trying to win the race would make his move going down the back straightaway in turn three and simply try to hold the second place car off as they come through the trial to the start-finish line.
But with the start-finish line down as far to turn one as it is, that's where the passing seems to have taken place in the past. So maybe moving it, doing it on turn three might be a little early.
It may be, but, you know, look, I'm the wrong one to ask because, believe me, I don't know where to be on the last lap. I've proved it time and time again.
Okay, from race to race, it does change, and it'll be interesting today to see who gets themselves in what position at the end.
Lavati closes up, pitches in on car number 28, Kelly Arbor, and here comes number 3, Earnhardt as well. Boy, those speeds, those individual laps, all over 195 miles per hour throughout the afternoon. Race here at Talladega, Alabama. Kale in front.
Well, Ken, you know, the early part of the race, the first half of the race, these guys were racing for the fun of it. They were racing to race, to outrun the other guys, to prove that their car was as good as anyone else. Now they're racing to win, to take the checker flag first. And it is an unbelievable chess game going on right now. Buddy Baker, I am so impressed. He backed up Ned to 8th place to conserve fuel, because he's going to conserve more fuel there than he is in 2nd and 3rd.
He certainly will, and that's sort of uncharacteristic for Buddy Baker, because he's a charger. He likes to run up front, but he's also smart.
He also wants to win, and that's right. What they're doing right now. Every one of those 19 cars is trying to figure out how to win.
360 degrees off our fire ladder camera. We worked the 138th lap, and we will have completed 367 miles, about 133 left to go.
Heat sometimes is a factor at this race. Has not been a factor here today. It's an ideal day for racing, particularly at Talladega in July. They're able to run the high speeds that we've been seeing here all day long, and also surprising, I should say, is that the attrition rate has been rather high. With the good conditions that we have here, it's overcast, and the temperature is perhaps in the low 80s, which is really good. But I guess the speed that they're running out here today has helped to cause the attrition.
You see the wind just wobbling a tad as they come off that fourth turn. Kenny Reagan, driving only his 23rd race in his whole career, running to that lead lap. He led one lap earlier today, first race he's ever led. Good, consistent racer.
He came here a couple of years ago, and the first race that he ever ran was here at Talladega. Now, Benny Parsons and I started on some of the dirt tracks before we started racing, and that's what usually recommended. You don't go to the fastest racetrack in the world, but Kenny Reagan did it and did well at it.
Another one of those people that believes in the old nothing to unlearn, that old line.
Yeah.
Now, there's the leader. Yarborough is there at issue. Can he stay there? Last year, he stayed up there most of the way. Then he cracked ahead on the car. He's finished second in this race twice.
And you know, Ned a moment ago just mentioned that Kenny Reagan did, in fact, come here for his first race. And there has people that did do that and got away with it. But there's also other people that paid a supreme price for doing it, because it does take a tremendous amount of experience to compete at these speeds.
Well, it's so easy to drive this track, but I think the point Darrell Waltrip made earlier, this is a track that can bite you, because if it happens so quickly. You don't rely on reactions, you have to rely on instinct here. There's Ken Reagan in the car number 77. He's been lying 17th over the past 15, 20 laps.
He's a car dealer from over Unadilla, Georgia. Very nice fellow and very determined young man.
Talk about determination. Look at the squadron up in front. Now, there's an enthusiast. You can tell by the hat who she's for.
Well, we're in Alabama. Bobby Allison's in Alabama.
Hey, those pictures of the grandstand give you an idea of what could be the newest aerobic exercise. seat in the grandstand and get up and down for 188 laps. Baker in the pits.
And as he did earlier, came in before anyone else. He just simply is not getting the gas mileage as some of the others are. Perhaps they'll be able to go 6, 7, or maybe as many as 10 laps. Gets to change the right side tire. Good pit stop. The Wood Brothers are among the best.
Got trouble in the back straightaway. Car number 28, Kaylee Yarborough, coming around. It is car 51, Greg Sachs. In the back straightaway has lost an engine. And the caution is out.
Amazingly, they'll be racing back to the flag as Kaylee Yarborough, which it doesn't do a whole lot to lead this lap as they come back to the front.
They've all stepped out of it. That's the second time for Baker. He just pitted and the caution comes out.
But with the good
work. Want a caution? Send Baker in.
Yeah, I guess. The good work of the Wood Brothers did get him back out. He'll stay in the lead lap. A tough break for Greg Sachs, who had run a super race here today. Kept himself up there in the lead pack. He's a rookie on this circuit. But to run this long and that hard, still in position to get himself a good finish or even perhaps a win. Anybody that's still in the lead lap is still a potential winner in this race. But now his hopes go up in smoke.
Cecil Gordon, crew chief on car 51, a man who ran many races himself on this track. Greg Sachs, number 51. So we should see the leaders coming in now, and the activity will all be on pit road. Mike Joy will be standing by, changing tires. They put the hood down.
That's surprising. We thought the engine blew with all that smoke, and that could have been a filter or something.
It could have blown the oil line off or something like that, because they were looked like they were planning on fixing the car and going back on the racetrack. They were changing tires.
Leaders coming in. This is happening in the 143rd lap. Here's Mike Joy.
Ready to head to pit road. Waddell Wilson has four tires up for Kaylee Yarborough. Now, they look carefully at Baker's pit stop to see if he got four tires or just gas just as the caution came out. Kale stays a bit far out from the wall, and they go to the right side first. Richard Bostic with the car up in the air. Joey Knuckles changing the right front tire. No chassis change. They have not changed the wedge on the chassis all day. Now everybody comes around. Bostic with that 65-pound jack, and they will change the left side tires. Let's go to Chris Economaki.
Well, this pit stop came at the right time to equalize this race. There's 37 laps to make 100 miles here. There's 43 laps to go. Unlikely that any car can get 43 laps on one tank of fuel. So now it's a brand new automobile race. It's like one of those basketball games with the first 100 even with 5 minutes to go. They'll all have to make one more pit stop, and the pit crew could win or lose it for the drivers today. Back to you, Ken.
Now we're down to it. Put prudence aside now.
There's been some cars that's gotten awfully good gas mileage this year. They're pushing Bodine's car down pit road. He has some sort of a problem. He's been right up in the thick of the battle all day, but as we've seen several times here today, after pit stop, they have problems as they go back out. But it seems to be in the firing of the engine this time, not in the drivetrain as we saw earlier. Apparently, he's got it going. But the point I was about to make, Ken, wouldn't surprise me, depending on the length of this caution, we might see some or maybe all of them come back in just to top off the fuel tank for that extra lap or two that they might get. But Bobby Allison has got extremely good gas mileage on numerous occasions this year, and so has Kaylee Yarborough. If there's anybody that's going to make it all the way from here, I'd say it'd be one of those two.
Or how about Travis Carter's car? Travis was saying he was getting as much range as anyone on car 33, and if he thought it got to that kind of a contest, he could be in good shape. We'll be back with you again in just a moment for the conclusion of today's Talladega 500. More live coverage of the Talladega 500 after this word from your local station.
Destination America, the back roads, the issues, the people. Charles Carrall and Bill Moyers meet up at Crossroads Wednesday. This is CBS.
The Olympic winning moment, sponsored by Snickers, official snack food of the 1984 Olympics.
Ron Delaney, 1956, Melbourne, starting the last lap in 10th place in the 1500-meter race. The Villanova student representing Ireland makes a remarkable finish to win with a record 3-minute, 41.2-second performance. For the U.S.-trained Irishman, a blazing Olympic winning moment.
When I was in serious Olympic training, I wanted a wholesome snack food, and my snacking habits really haven't changed much. Snickers, I think, is the ideal snack food for me. What makes it wholesome is just merely the ingredients.
Packed with fresh peanuts, peanut butter nougat, caramel, and milk chocolate.
Satisfies you.
Packed with peanuts, Snickers really satisfies.
It just satisfies me.
Official snack food of the 1984 Olympic Games. Eagles versus Lions, Saturday at 7.
We're back with you live at the Alabama International Motor Speedway inside Jeff Bodine's car. Jeff, what happened to you after you came off pit road that time, or as you came out of the pits?
Yeah, we ran out of gas on that caution lap just before we entered the pits, and the car wouldn't start. They had to push it. We're okay now, but it just wouldn't start. It didn't have any gas.
Boy, you talk about a caution coming at the right time. It did for you then, didn't it?
Right. We were going to pit anyway that next lap, but when we slowed down and got up on that banking, the little fuel we had left went away for the pickup, and we ran out.
Jeff, how do you feel about your chances at this point now?
Well, the car's handling awful good. If we could just avoid some trouble and just hang in there, I think we have a chance at a good finish. There's a lot of cars that are a lot faster and stronger than we are. We can't get out front, Joe, but you never know on that last lap here at Talladega.
Are you going to have to make another pit stop for fuel?
Yeah, I think so.
Thank you very much. Jeff Bodine in car number 5, currently running 15th. Terry Labonte coming back on the track. Interesting circumstance on Travis Carter's car, the number 33, Benny.
Travis has a fuel flow meter on Harry's car that tells how much liquid has went through this meter. In other words, Harry can sit there and watch the thing and tell when they've used 21 gallons of gas. And here, that's about all they can pick up, would probably be 21 to 21 and a half gallons. So when he gets to 21, he tells him, I'm coming in. Quite an innovation, it really is. I think Ron Bouchard is on pit road right now with some trouble, Kim.
Car 47. Ron Bouchard still on pit road as the field is gathered up for a restart, and Bouchard's hopes in this race may be plummeting right here.
Okay, well, he gets it to going, so he's going to remain in the lead lap. He's going to have to run hard to catch the field, and then moving into turn 3 now. We're still under caution, but the green's scheduled to come out when they come around this time.
Actually, if he builds up ahead of steam down that back straightaway, it could be a little bit of an advantage for him.
Could be. He might be running 190 miles an hour where they're accelerating from 75.
Want to be very careful with a bowling ball like that at that speed. Now, there you see the point standings. With Dale Earnhardt up in first, Bill Elliott is second, Labonte third, and Waltrip back in fourth place.
But still not too far out of the lead. Again, less than 100 points separating him from the lead, so it's a very tight battle as we get ready for a very tight race here.
And Earnhardt will be in front with Bobby Allison, as you see in the white, number 22 in second spot. Third is Waltrip. Fourth is Cale. Fifth is Gant. Sixth is Elliott. Seventh is Speed. Is Baker on the restart. Here's Elliott. Watching the meters on Bill Elliott's car as they scramble. Pulls up on Harry Gant. No rev counter climbing on it. That's not altitude. See the fuel meter on that car.
Yeah, he has one of those things in there too, Phoenix.
That boy's about Dahlonega, Georgia surprised me with their knowledge.
There are no secrets that last more than 24 hours.
That's exactly right, Ken.
Allison for the moment, down low. That move by Gannon, he scoots around. Strategy report, and we see Earnhardt going back in front, and here comes Bodine. Bodine onto pit road, something amiss on car number 5, and he's going right back to the garage area. Unfortunate situation for Jeff Bodine.
Let me tell you what happens when you run out of fuel. At the RPMs that these engines are turning, when you run out of fuel, you instantly get air in there and no fuel, and you burn a piston. You just lift the top right off the piston because it gets so hot. Running out of fuel is the worst thing you can do to one of these engines.
Had a driver replacement. Greg Sachs has replaced Ken Reagan in car 77. Reagan was overcome by fumes, and he was groggy in the pit area, so Greg Sachs has taken over in car number 77. Strategy report. Here's Chris Economaki.
Well, down along pit road, fuel again becomes the story. These are the men in Bobby Allison's pit with their little calculators and computers. Allison has been getting great gas mileage this year, and they say they think they can make it. They're going to try without another pit stop. Buddy Baker's pit crew says there's no way they can go 43 laps on one tank of gas. They know they're going to have to stop again. And Tommy Ellis and his crew, they're happy up there. They don't know whether they can make it or not, but they say they're going to try, and let come what may, come what may. Back to you, Ken.
149 laps completed this time by of 188. 149, 396 miles down. There's Petty, still determined, still trying, well off the pace.
Well, Bodine, we saw him coasting into the garage area, and Mike Joy is with him.
In the garage area, not the place you wanted to end this afternoon. What happened?
Engine let go. No, we're running so darn good. The car was handling great. Hi, everybody back home, Rick. But she just let go on that restart. We ran out of gas. I don't know if we burned a piston when we ran out of gas and it broke or what, but everything was going so good that, you know, it's really a shame.
Boy, do you look hot.
Not too bad, Mike. I was having a ball. The car handled so good. It drove so good, I could go high or low. And I was just having a good time out there. And it isn't too hot. It's very comfortable. But here we are.
Well, he's won two short track races, Ken, but he'll get to luxuriate in the garage the rest of this afternoon.
Dale Earnhardt, Kannapolis, North Carolina, leads. 9 career wins. Will this be number 10? Waltrip into second, knocking on the door. First turn. Yarborough third.
Earnhardt hasn't won so far in 1984, Ken, even though he's leading the points now.
Here he is out of turn number 2. Earnhardt, who won this race a year ago. The car has been getting stronger all the time.
Ken, I tell you what, you're looking at a lot of cars, bumper to bumper, that can win this race, that has the car, that has the crew, that has the ability to win this race. And where the winner's going to come from is anybody's guess.
Earnhardt first drove in this race in 1978. Will Cronkite and finished 12th. Now he's leading. 150 laps have been completed. More in a moment.
How old should your child be before you buy a computer? High school, when he's planning a career? Elementary school, when she can either fall behind or leap ahead? Or preschool, to give him a head start? When you buy is up to you, but Commodore makes the decision easier than any other computer. Because it's a 64, it's very powerful. Because it's Commodore, it's very affordable.
From Newport News to Newport Beach, from the Australian Outback to Abilene, more men face the day with Gillette Good News than any other disposable razor. Because Gillette twin blades shave better than one. And for men all over the world, the name Gillette stands for shaving. And Good News stands alone as the world's number one disposable razor. Now more good news for a better shave. Good News Pivot, only from Gillette.
The Wall Street Journal is written for busy people. It doesn't waste your time with what you don't want to know. Make sure that you don't miss anything you have to know. Accurate, to the point, complete. The Wall Street Journal. It's all here.
Save $7.50 off the cover price with a subscription to the Wall Street Journal. Order 19 weeks for $39. Phone toll-free 800-228-2210. That's 19 weeks, just $39. And save $7.50. Phone 800-228-2210.
Roger Staubach for Rolaids.
When I race through a meal, I get terrible indigestion.
How do you spell relief?
R-O-L-A-I-D-S. 100% relief.
R-O-L-A-I-D-S. I've tried others, and Rolaids is what really works for me.
Like a sponge, Rolaids antacid medicine consumes 100% of the acid required to give millions 100% relief.
I spell it R-O-L-A-I-D-S. And what could be better than 100% relief?
For millions of Americans, Rolaids spells 100% relief.
Next, the PGA Pros will shoot for the title when play continues at the 33rd Hartford Open. Live coverage on CBS Sports.
196 miles an hour in the last lap. Dale Earnhardt stays in front. Buddy Baker has meandered up the third. Here he is coming to the inside, making a move. Baker down low, now pulls up and battles for first place going into turn number one. Nearly 100,000 people on their feet watching 16 drivers competing for first place. Ned, remember when you won the Southern 500 and you won it by
14 laps. My, how times have changed.
They certainly have, Ken. It's unbelievable that you still have, and any one of these 16 cars that Bennett said earlier are still capable of winning this race out here. And I think Bennett said he finished second to Darlington one time with 12 or 13 laps down.
I was 13 laps down. David Pearson won the race, and I was 13 laps down in second.
Just doesn't happen anymore.
Bumper to bumper, 200 mile per hour expressway action here at Talladega, Alabama, live today on CBS. Coming up next, the Greater Hartford golf action next on CBS. This crowd just so appreciative of the tremendous effort by all of these great drivers. And Baker, with some of the wildest driving, has just eased up through. He really makes the others pay attention to what he's doing.
Heaton has put that car in some holes today that you wouldn't think it would go in, but the car has to be working perfectly for it to be able to do that. Now Yarborough's going to move up and see if he can get draft away from the rest of the field, but Earnhardt's going to have different ideas.
That's right. Earnhardt saying, thank you very much. I'll have none of that. There's Earnhardt, blue and yellow car, number three in third. Waltrip is in fourth, and Gant lies fifth. Cars in that lead draft, 16 cars in the lead lap as the Warpath moves to its 155th lap. 156 now complete of 188. 32 laps to go. Here is Mike Joy with a crew chief on Earnhardt's car.
Well, Ken, the timing of that caution flag may have changed race end strategy, but maybe not for the better. Richard, did that caution come out a lap too early for Dale Earnhardt?
Looks like it's going to be about three laps too early for us, you know, so we're going to fall back and try to use a little bit of the draft and see what it looks like toward the end of the race there now.
Well, that'll improve your fuel economy, but can you gain three laps that way?
I don't think so, but we're going to see what it looks like when we get down to the very end, you know.
Boy, are they hoping for a caution flag, Ken. One more before this race is over.
Oh, trouble.
Here, got it.
Benny, crashing. That is the Trevor Boyce car. In big trouble out of turn number four. That's a hard way to get a caution.
That was not the way that Richard Childress wanted it. He's moving around. He's just cut the switches off. He's coming out of the car after taking a ride like that, getting out that quickly. Another indication of how well these automobiles are put together, because that was not an easy ride.
You know, Ned, when he reached up to turn the switches off, my first thought was he was trying to start the car to go again.
You're watching it live here on CBS. Let's look at it in replay as to what happened to Trevor Boyce, who's been running right up there all afternoon.
Okay, he gets hooked. It looks like that Tommy Ellis car right behind him, and they just touch enough, and it shoots his car down to the inside. The air gets underneath the car, flips it over backwards. It hits hard on the top, scoops up the end of pit road there on the top. It hits the grass area, flips back over all the way over and back on the wheel. And up on the side and lands back on the wheels once again like a big bucking horse.
Summer rodeo ride for Trevor Boyce of Calgary.
You know, as the rodeo performers would say, he chose a good steed for that performance there, I'll tell you.
Stopping to tie his shoe. Let's take a look and replay.
They're coming off of turn four. It looks like he drifts out just a little bit, Ken. Tommy Ellis on the outside of him there, and he hit just enough to send him around, and the air got underneath the car, sends it right upside down. Benny, what happens when that air gets under there?
I don't know, Ned.
Pressure?
At Daytona, watching this action that we're seeing on the screen reminds me so much of the Ricky Rudd crash from Daytona in the Busch Clash that we had in February. But, you know, and they paved that section down in Daytona because they felt like that the cars coming off the pavement onto the dirt made the car bounce and therefore got air under the cars. That car never reached the grass before it flipped over. So that destroys that thought that they had.
They moved that wall back too, have they?
They moved the wall back and they paved that entire area thinking that that was some of the problem. But as you notice,
when you think of the Randy LaJoy crash where he took that several others like Harry Gant several years ago, you see, he was all ready for business, and I thought you were right. He was reaching around to see if he could get the thing fired. No, he was just turning it down. Oh, that's too bad for James Hilton as well as for Trevor Boyce. James Hilton, one of the really nice people.
Here they are again. As they come off of that turn, he went up into the groove there and just clipped the front bumper of Tommy Ellis' car number four, and it doesn't take much at those kind of speeds. They shot him right down across the racetrack. That's Phil Parsons there doing a very heads-up piece of driving, got slowed down enough. And Ben, as you say, just as he got to the edge of the pavement, getting onto the grass is when he got airborne.
Tommy doesn't have to look for trouble. Trouble finds him. And that car just came up on him. And
yeah,
what are you
going to do? Nowhere he could go. No, nothing he could do because there was cars right on his bumper and in that heavy traffic. Too bad for a young fellow who had perhaps driven the best race of his career here today. Trevor Boyce had stayed right up there in the thick of the battle all afternoon long, still in the lead lap.
Trevor Boyce is okay walking away from this crash. 158 laps are now completed, the 188 to be run in today's Talladega 500.
Don't talk to me about high tech. You fellas know I'm used to some pretty sophisticated filter systems.
Test pilot Chuck Yeager for AC Delco.
Now, I don't care what kind of car you drive. The filters you want to buy are AC filters. An AC oil filter can serve you up to 15,000 miles. An air filter, clean up to 30,000 miles. The choice is yours. But for my money, it's AC Delco, the smart parts.
Forget everything you know about shaving and get ready for the extraordinary. Get ready for Edge Extra Gel. The extraordinary gel with over 40% more lubricants than the leading foam. For extraordinary closeness. Extraordinary comfort. Experience Edge Extra Gel.
Buds for everyone who takes the power and sends it down the line.
This Buds for you. For all you do, the King of Beers is coming through.
Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do, this Buds for you.
Forget everything you know about shaving and get ready for the extraordinary. Get ready for Edge Extra Gel. The extraordinary gel with over 40% more lubricants than the leading foam. For extraordinary closeness. Extraordinary comfort. Experience Edge Extra Gel.
Sixty laps will be complete of 188, this time by the start-finish line. Trevor Boyce has crashed. Let's go to Mike Joy.
For sale, slightly used, one Winston Cup race car. Also doubles as lawnmower when it comes through the infield here. This car, the passenger compartment is completely intact. Due to the NASCAR safety rules, Trevor climbed out of this unscathed. But the rest of the car, well, it's headed for the junkyard, and it certainly leaves the question, with this potential, why do these fellas do this?
As you watch a major incident unfold at 200 miles per hour, it leaves an indelible memory imprint. Those terrifying seconds when a driver's life is in the balance, they're not easily forgotten. So how is it that moments after something as frightening as this, that other drivers go about their business, a business which could tap them next with such seeming ease?
It can't happen to me. Even though I can show you a few places and broke feet and ribs and cut places. But basically, it always happens to the other fella. And it's just part of the sport that I have never really thought that much about.
Bill Parsons, brother of former Daytona winner Benny Parsons, survived this terrifying series of spirals last May at Talladega, Alabama. And he never looked back.
There's nothing like racing to me. It's in my blood. It's all I've ever wanted to do, and it's all I ever want to do. I'm not going to let a little thing like a little crash take it out of me.
For brother Benny, it was a different story, briefly.
I rode by, and the car was laying there on the roof, front burning. And, I mean, that's probably one of the worst moments of my life. I mean, it really was. It was horrendous. I mean, I thought I was able, I would be able to handle it. You know, I just thought I'd be there, but I couldn't.
It doesn't happen often, but when it does, the top drivers mentally put it away. It's called racing attitude. On this level of the game, there is no room for any other attitude.
We are back live. They have just taken the green flag. As they approach the first turn, they're coming back to full speed another time. Ron Bouchard of Pittsburgh, Massachusetts, the 1981 winner of the event is riding in first place as they go down into the back straightaway. In second place is car 75. And that is the Dave Marcus car, the man who won this race many years ago from the pole position, the only man to ever win it from the pole. And then comes Darrell Waltrip in third. We're live with you at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. They will complete 162 of 188 laps this time by. And that, Jarrett, we now have 14 cars gathered up for the bench.
And the strategy of the pit stop, the need for a pit stop for fuel has gone out the window. They can all go the distance now, so it's going to be some kind of a shootout right down to the end.
The frenzied action is all right here on the high banks of the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Ron Bouchard up in front. That second spot now belongs to Darrell Waltrip. The only two-time winner of the event goes to the inside. He fires up into turn number three and goes for the lead, and Baker in the Ford comes with him.
Baker has proven all afternoon that that Ford has what it takes to get up front and to be run among the front runners here all afternoon. Now, Waltrip really, he killed some strength several different times, but now, as Danny said earlier, we're running for the roses now. The cash is on the line, so he'll show what he has.
Across the line, Waltrip becomes the 16th different leader in the event. If more than 10 cars finish in the lead lap, that would be a record for this race. Looks like we're going to have it. There you see them. Out of two. Back for another time at first comes Baker, and with him comes Bouchard, and Waltrip is falling back. That move in the last lap of the International Race of Champions. You saw at the top of our program today that gave him the win, and he came from fourth or fifth.
Baker does not want to be in this position again because he lost in Daytona a couple of years being the leader and leading the race for the last 20, 30 laps until Yarborough slingshot by. He does not want to be in front, but I think he felt like Darrell Walker was just a bit too slow for him, and therefore he passed Darrell.
You see Earnhardt in fourth, and you see Labonte up to fifth.
Sometimes they'll make a pass of that sort, too, hoping that the car that they're bringing with them might just give them a good shot, that they might move out 8 or 10 car lengths and hopefully break the draft from the other cars back there. But most of these cars have been running here all day long. I don't see that happening. They get 4 or 5 car lengths, like we see right there on Walter. But I think they'll be able to pick that up and pick right back up through the front row.
Bill Elliott's car that started outside of the front row, back in 8th or 9th, right behind Cale Yarborough. Here they are, back for the tri-oval. 200 miles an hour. Lined up on parade. 8th position. Elliott right in front of him. Yarborough. Now Yarborough takes a meander up the outside. Allison blocked at him. Back straightaway. Top 9 altogether. Here's Bouchard riding right to Baker. Laps complete, 166 of 188 this time by.
Again, there have been some awfully good finishes here at Talladega, Daytona, Charlotte, wherever. Last Sunday at Pocono, Pennsylvania, tremendous finish among three cars battling for the lead. But never in the history of the sport have we had this many cars running this strong, this near the end of the race. I think that we're going to be in for history.
And all with full tanks. There's always been that fallout with pit stops and green flag conditions. That is not the case here.
Well, certainly the fans don't want to go away. They better stay glued to their TV sets, as these fans here are just standing up. They haven't had much sitting time here this afternoon. They didn't really need these seats here today.
You know, I was thinking of that a moment ago. They paid good money for those seats and didn't use them all day.
They'll spend half an hour after just sitting in them trying to collect themselves. Bakery's led, what, 15 times net?
15 times for 27 laps. And that makes him the biggest leader in the event. Normally, the top winner, you know, he's going to lead half of the race.
Beginning to switch the position. You can see Waltrip getting anxious. He comes up to third. Let's go to Chris Economak.
Well, Ken, there's smiles up and down pit road here. All the mechanics and crew chiefs have done their work. They all say now that it's up to the driver. There's enough gas to go to the end. The tires are good, and it's a driver's going to win this race, not some piece of strategy or some work by a crew chief. And they're all sitting here relaxing, knowing that their man is capable of winning. Thank you, Ken.
Third place car is now Waltrip, the man who's won it 2 times. Darrell Waltrip, can you be the first driver to win the Talladega 500 3 times?
Well, I've won it twice. I almost won it two other times. And I don't know, the last couple of years, Ron Bouchard beat me at the start-finish line by foot. And last year, Earnhardt beat me at the start-finish line by about the same distance. So had a shot at winning both of those races, and that would have given me four wins.
Right now, he's falling back. Earnhardt pulling up.
Yes, the car doesn't seem to be that strong. He got up in front there a moment ago, but he wasn't able to stay up there. As Benny pointed out, Baker wanted to get back in front of him because he didn't think Waltrip was leading him fast enough. Waltrip's able to stay in there in fourth place right now, but it just doesn't seem to have the muscle, Benny.
He doesn't seem to have the muscle to stay up front with those good cars, with the Bakers, the Bouchards, and the Yarbroughs. You know, Cale Yarbrough, the pole sitter, is back in the sixth or seventh spot right now, trying his best to get through traffic. But he's got six good cars, almost as fast as he right in front of him. He can't make it.
169 this time by. 15 cars to lead lap. Bobby Hillen out of Midland, Texas, 20 years old, is still up here. 15 cars to lead lap. He's the 15th. 14th right now is Ricky Rudd. And Tommy Elsie got an
engine
scattering.
And there's a smoker down on the inside.
Like Arrington.
Buddy Arrington.
Chrysler.
Going he gets it low on the racetrack. Anything out on the track, but he made a very smart move as the leaders were coming around on the outside. He got it down to the low side of the racetrack, and now it's coasting on around. They ran that last lap at well over 200 miles per hour. So they're, what we say in, up in North Carolina, getting on with the getting on now.
170 laps this time by will have been completed of the 188. There's the business end of the Talladega 500.
Kyle Petty down on the inside, he's been running at reduced speed for some time now. He had an overheating problem early in the race, lost a number of laps in the pit, so he's just trying to ride it out and get whatever points he can.
Nearly $500,000 at stake. And the divvy gets pretty small after that first and second place for these fellows. He had these big, high-buck teams. Ricky Rudd's sister there.
That was one of the other crew members that you thought it was Carolyn Rudd.
I was watching the race myself.
Benny don't pay attention to things like that.
Car number 21, Baker stays there. Bouchard right on the rear bumper.
He has run a good race here. Very good race. The car is working well down on the inside.
Let's get a report on Trevor Boyce.
I'm with Dr. Dave Fretz outside the Hardwick Care Center. How is Trevor? How is Trevor Boyce?
Trevor's fine. A few bumps and bruises. He'll be sore tomorrow, but no permanent problems.
Apparently, Ken, he bumped the number four car, got the car a little bit sideways, and then it took off when it hit the grass. But Trevor's resting comfortably, and he's talking with his crew chief about going up to Canada to run a stock car race tomorrow.
Buddy Arrington, you saw his car pull into the pits just as we left to join Mike Joy. Bouchard going for first place. Ron Bouchard back to first. Baker to second. Probably that's what Baker wants.
And Bouchard might be testing whether going into turn three where he made that pass, is that the place he can do it? Now he wants to see, can I stay out front till we get back to the start-finish line? Of course, there's going to be a lot of other things come into play with that many cars still running there at the end. This time he is going to be able to stay up front, but there'll be a lot of other jockeying going on behind him, and that could affect how he comes across the start-finish line.
Bill Elliott back to eighth, now sweeps under Bobby Allison, closes up on car number 28. Cale Yarbrough, as he continues to make his charge and try to win the Talladega 500.
Excited to drive for freedom now. Some days your job takes only 24 seconds, the most important 24 seconds of the race. It's the difference between winning and just being another car on the track. Nobody knows the sensation of winning better than Union 76, because we've fueled more winners than anyone ever.
That winning quality rides with you every time you ride out of a Union 76 station.
Go with the spirit.
Stick with the winner.
The spirit of 76.
The final basket. Match point. The last lap. Right now, your body's thirsty for more than water. It needs thirst aid. Gatorade.
Gatorade is thirst aid for the deep down body thirst.
When you exercise, you lose more than water. You lose potassium, minerals, fluids. Gatorade puts it all back fast. It's no ordinary thirst quencher. It's thirst aid.
Gatorade is thirst aid for the deep down body thirst.
Next, the PGA pros will shoot for the title when play continues at the 33rd Hartford Open. Live coverage on CBS Sports.
175 laps complete, 13 to go. Next on CBS, the Hartford Open. Peter Jacobson still leading. Mark O'Meara in that contest with Pretzer maintaining third. Right now, it continues to be a shuffle here. And Bill Elliott has pulled up into fourth. Meanwhile, a change for the lead. Buddy Baker is going back in front. Kaylee Yarbrough trying to pull beneath the car number three of Dale Earnhardt. And there lies number nine, Elliott, who's come from eighth up to fourth. Is there an ideal place to be when it comes down to the last few laps, Bill Elliott?
It's hard to say, depending on how many cars are left in the lead lap, because that has always changed the situation. If there's only two cars left, being second more than likely is the place to be. But if there's possibly four or five cars left, leading the race may be where you need to be, because if you get all those other guys racing among themselves, you can possibly get out away from them.
For all the marbles, Elliott has been riding down on the inside Benny Parsons and seems to make that car work as well on the bottom side of the track as any car here.
He has been as good on the inside as anyone. Terry Labonte just a moment ago passed several cars on the inside and went to second place. He's in the catbird seat right now, but the catbird seat keeps shifting every lap. Someone else has a different perspective at it.
Now, Ron Bichard has gone from first to 11th in the last two laps.
The leader, Baker. Second, Terry Labonte. Third is Earnhardt. He's been one dominating factor up in that front five. It has seemed to be Earnhardt, but he just hasn't had it to close. Playing it close, is that what he has? And there's Yarbrough, line four. Almost touching out of turn two at over 200 miles an hour.
And they can't last to go when they come back in, so everybody is trying to jockey now. They will be doing this for the next 10 laps, trying to get themselves in position. Now, Bill Elliott said it'd be different if you got four or five cars in the lead lap as to your strategy on that last lap. Nobody considers that there might be 14 of them.
66 lead changes. One more will tie the record for this race held by... Well, it goes back to the 1978 year when Lenny Pond won it. They had 67 lead changes. When we can tie it with one more lead change for this event. There is an overall record that's considerably higher based on the race back in May. Here's a report from Chris Economek.
I just asked this man, Glenn Wood, how it looked with this driver in the lead. He gave me three words. He says, 28's are coming.
Yarbrough used to drive for that man, Glenn Wood, and he knows how tenacious he can be at times, and he has seen that car run so many times this year. As Benny Parsons mentioned at the top of the broadcast, it has been dominant in practically every race that it has run.
Out of turn number four, back for the tri-oval another time. Baker is hitting himself a five-car length advantage. Earnhardt is in second, Cale is in third, Labonte is in fourth, Allison is in fifth, Lake Speed is in sixth, Waltrip is in seventh. Bill Elliott is following well back, and look at number four. Here comes Tommy Ellis out of Virginia, just doing a grand job in this McClure car, staying right in there. Harry Gant up in front of him, Ron Bouchard on his right flank. Out in front, it is still Baker. Baker draws away by five car lengths. Bill Elliott right there behind Tommy Ellis, who now puts the pedal down.
He has done a great job of just hanging right up there with those leaders all day long. He's never had this much experience in running in the draft for that long of a period of time, because he's never had a car that run this long.
You're not like running Langley Field. Here he is back to the tri-oval. Here's Chris Economaki.
Well, we just asked, and we saw Grover and the Buddy Baker's pit crew smiling. I said, what's so funny? He said, Buddy just asked what to do.
There's no help from down there at this point of the race, believe me.
Yeah, thank God. See a thousand things going through their mind out there. They got to keep their mind on what they're doing, you know, while they're running at 200 miles an hour, not run over somebody or get too close to somebody, put themselves out of it. But they got to also be thinking, well, what am I going to do to get myself in position to win this race? Every one of them knows they're there, that they got the chance to win the race. The cars run fast enough, as Benny said earlier. They've got all the ingredients there, but just getting themselves in the right position as we get down right at the end of this race.
Baker drawing away just a little bit here by about half a car length. Laps complete. As they come down across the start-finish line, sweeping past Kyle Petty coming out of the pistons. 181 complete of 188. Trying the bottom of the racetrack, Terry Labonte, number 44, the Billy Hagan car. Crew chief Dale Inman goes into second place. The Waddell Wilson car, the Harry Rainier machine of Cale Yarborough lying fourth and sandwiching himself in there so neatly is Labonte. Now here he comes, driving to the inside, and Earnhardt comes with it.
I'll tell you, that looked strong. When he pulled up coming off of turn two, slipped right up to about three cars, and then decided to go ahead and take the lead and did it and moved right out three or four car lengths in front.
They may have Cale hung out to dry. No, he got back in. I thought maybe now they're going to pass the dominant car in the race. I thought was going to go. He's going on back. They got the 28 car going back.
Allison pulls up. Bobby Allison becomes a factor once again as he goes to fourth. Baker lies third. Laps running down. And there are six to go. Six laps remaining. We're coming to you live from Talladega, Alabama. You are inside Bill Elliott's car as he begins to make his charge. Final moments of this race at 200 miles per hour. It's being decided. Terry Labonte out of Corpus Christi, Texas is now leading. Dale Earnhardt, former national champion, winner of this event a year ago, in the second position.
There's Earnhardt's wife, Teresa. She naturally is excited. She wants to see him win two in a row here at Talladega.
Buddy Baker in that third spot. No one has ever won it back-to-back. Only Waltrip has won it twice. To go as they reach the line. Terry Labonte. They have prepped this car for a considerable amount of time, getting it set for this race. Again, it's one of the most important races for them this year. Took some extra time. Will it pay off? Meanwhile, that Richard Childress car, the number three for Dale Earnhardt, that Chevrolet works in second place.
I think he's sitting exactly where he wants to be right now, Ken. He's also got to take into consideration that Buddy Baker's sitting right there on his lap. I think Buddy's pretty well where he wants to be because he knows Earnhardt's going to make a move, and he figures he'll pick, when they get side by side, he'll pick the draft for both of them up, and he'll fill that position on the last lap and be able to draft fast. Where Earnhardt figures, well, those others back there are going to be racing with each other, that it'll slow them down.
Here's
Labonte's got to be thinking the same thing. So.
Here's Mike Joy. Four laps to go.
Does Dale Earnhardt tell you he's in the spot where he wants to be? Is he in the spot he wants to be, does he say?
I don't know, we ain't talked lately. We just letting him drive. He's driving as hard as he can right now, I'm sure.
And they're counting the gas drop by drop. You guys may not make it, or we'll make it now. We got the gas made. It's just, it depends on no telling who may win the race right now. It's going to be an interesting finish. Crew's done their job. It's all up to the driver.
Earnhardt looks low. Goes down to the bottom. Actually, he stayed stable in 44, pulled up a little. Now here they are out of four. What about Allison, Benny Parsons? Is he where he wants to be?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think so. I don't think he's quite up as far as he'd like to be. Buddy Baker's spot, third spot, I think anybody would take that spot, or Dale Earnhardt. But any other spot than that, I don't think that's where they want to be. Do you, Dan?
Other than maybe Labonte, because he's got to know that Baker is going to make a move on Earnhardt, which might slow both of them down a little bit. So the front position might not be a bad position to be in. Other than those positions, I don't know.
Cale is fifth. Back straight away.
Bouchard has dropped off the pace. Ronnie Bouchard has dropped off the pace after a tremendous run today.
Waltrip is sixth. Blake Speed is in seventh. Harry Gant is in eighth. Ellis is in ninth. Bill Elliott back to tenth. Getting down to the finish. Show and tell time at the Alabama International Motor Speedway.
Well, it'll be just a fraction over 5 miles.
Two laps to go. joining us for the Greater Hartford. There's two laps remaining here in Talladega, Alabama. Dale Inman, crew chief for Terry Labonte. Watching that slim lead, knowing that Earnhardt is getting ready to shoot his shot. And here comes the field closing. A record number of cars clustered together, ready to fight it out at 200 miles an hour. And Harry Gant on the inside, the man into the hounding of Burt Reynolds' car, number 33, begins to make his move low on the track. He pulls alongside. He's fighting with Buddy Baker now, trying for third.
Now, that's one of the better things that can happen to those front two cars. Tommy Ellis trying to come up on the inside. They were on the radio trying to get Terry Labonte to get out of the lead, but with all that jockeying going on behind him, he still might be in the best place to come around for the white flag.
One lap to go. As this tremendous group of cars thunders into turn number one, Terry Labonte in front. Earnhardt is there in second. Then in third, it's Buddy Baker on the outside. Bobby Allison is in fourth. Harry Gant is on the inside in fifth. At 200 miles an hour, all of these cars contesting for the lead. Earnhardt closes ground. He's going to try the high side. Earnhardt going to turn three at 200 miles an hour. Winds it up. Fires it in there. And it's Earnhardt going in front. Baker to second. Labonte back to third. It is still Allison in fourth. And now on the inside, Terry Labonte begins to move. Labonte back to second as they switch positions and shuffle down out of the turn. Dale
right for Earnhardt. They're racing for second back there. Open the door for Earnhardt.
As they come out of the tri-oval, headed for the line, the question will be who will be second. The checkered flag belongs today to the Richard Childress crew. Dale Earnhardt has done it again. The first man to ever win it 2 years in a row. Dale Earnhardt's crowd on pit road, ecstatic, as they've just done it. The first team to ever win the Talladega 500, two solid straight times. A brilliant maneuver by Earnhardt in the last moments of the race.
It was a very brilliant move. Now, he drove Bud Moore's car to victory here a year ago, same sponsor, but Earnhardt has won in two different big cars, the Ford last year, a Chevrolet here this year.
Let's take a look again as well then for second place as they come to the line. There's Earnhardt, and as they began to struggle for second, it gave just a bit of an advantage to Dale Earnhardt, who had made his move on the outside, going to turn number three, broken away from the draft, and took himself to first place. And in for second place, hello.
He looked like Labonte. Labonte maybe just a few inches.
So that's the story of the 1984 Talladega 500. This man, Dale Earnhardt, is successful and the first man to ever win it 2 years back-to-back. For Ned Jarrett, Chris Economaki, and Mike Joy, this is Ken Squire saying so long from the Alabama International Motor Speedway. Production assistance provided by Curb Motorsports, Harry S. Milling, Milling Racing, and All-Star Racing. Coming up next on CBS Sports, final round coverage of the Greater Hartford Open. The Talladega 500 has been a presentation of CBS Sports.